Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call this meeting to order. I'd like to do an acknowledgement at this time. At this time, I'd like to acknowledge the Indigenous peoples of the traditional territory on which we have gathered today, the Anishinaabe peoples, the Haudenosaunee peoples, and the Lenni Lenape peoples. Could we all stand for O Canada? Corporate Supervisor Shannon Smith for a roll call. I'd like to mention that Chair Pizzolatto is not present tonight. I'm the acting chair. Chair Pizzolatto is unwell tonight. She's at home. She'll be online. And Lorianne, we wish you all a speedy recovery and wish you back here soon. In my place, Trustee Rahman will be acting vice chair. Thank you, Trustee Rahman. Acting Corporate Supervisor Smith, would you do a roll call, please?
Thank you, and through you, Chair. Trustee Antone?
Present.
Chair Cuddy?
Present.
Trustee Gonzalez?
Present.
Trustee Hart?
Present.
Trustee Hunt?
Present.
Trustee Moore?
Present.
Trustee Morrell? Trustee Pizzolatto?
Here.
Trustee Polhill?
Present.
Trustee Rahman?
Present.
Trustee Ruddick?
Present.
Trustee Smith?
Present.
Trustee Yeoman?
Present.
Student Trustee Sathaskumar?
Present.
Student Trustee Sabani?
Present.
Student Trustee Whiteye? Trustee Morrell? Thank you.
Thank you, Acting Corporate Supervisor Smith. We'll move on now to Strategic Plan in Action. Director Fisher.
It's my pleasure this evening to call upon Superintendent Kevin Auckland to introduce the team from Wilberforce Public School.
Good evening. It is my sincere pleasure to welcome Principal Marcy Damon and Vice Principal Angela G from Wilberforce Public School to share the strategic plan in action with us this evening. Principal Damon, Vice Principal G, and the entire Wilberforce team have worked extremely hard this year to get to know their learners, as well as put intentional and targeted plans in place to support the literacy needs of students at Wilberforce Public School. Thank you so much for joining us this evening to share with us your literacy journey this year. I will now turn it over to Principal Damon.
Thank you and good evening. We're very excited to be here and to share how we have worked as a school team at Wilberforce to achieve goal one, objective one of the operational plan. Let just going to set my screen here. Sorry about that. Although there are many exciting things happening related to literacy learning at Wilberforce, tonight we want to focus on how we have worked towards ensuring that students are successful readers by the end of grade two. At Wilberforce, we are committed to the important job of supporting all of our students in becoming readers. We truly have so much to celebrate and wanted to start by showing just one example of the gains that students have made. This is a photo of a class summary. The rows represent students and each of the columns represents reading or writing skills. Educators gather assessment data related to these foundational reading skills throughout the year and create color-coded summaries to build a visual representation of the data. The green that you see in this chart indicates that a student has acquired a skill. The yellow indicates that the student is sometimes able to demonstrate the skill, and the red indicates that the student does not yet have the skill. So as you can see in September, many students had not yet acquired a lot of the skills needed to be a fluent reader, as they're coded in yellow or red. But this second photo represents data collected in March of 2022. And as you can see in this visual, there is much more green. Through explicit instruction and intentional interventions, many more of these students have acquired the foundational skills necessary for reading. So how did we get there? Well, as we entered into a new school year, our staff were energized and excited to be back in person. We all knew that our students would be returning to us, having had varied experiences during the pandemic and online learning over the past 2 years. And we recognized that learning recovery and renewal would be different for each of our students. Our priority as we welcomed our students back was to begin by building positive and safe learning environments. We recognize that relationships, safety, and connection are essential conditions for learning that support the mental health and well-being of our students. Our educators began to get to know their students as learners. They gathered assessment data to inform their programming and next steps. They used tools such as the phonological awareness screener to understand early reading skill development, the primary spelling inventory to understand writing skill development, and diagnostic reading assessment or benchmark assessment system to understand overall skills. And then from here, educators built class and individual student summaries. And then we met as grade teams and as a literacy team, which included our classroom teachers, learning support teachers, our speech language pathologist, and administration to review the data and strategically plan how we were going to support our learners and work towards the operational goal of having all students be successful readers by the end of grade two. We recognize that our kindergarten and grade one students may not have had a consistent and solid foundation of explicit instruction to this point in their educational experiences. Therefore, it was important for us to focus our attention on core classroom best practices for all students, tier one. We didn't want to jump to tier two, where more intensive interventions are implemented until we ensured that students had experienced consistent classroom instruction that meets the needs of all students in foundational reading skills. Programs which target phonemic and phonological awareness were used by grade one educators daily. Sound walls were also used to support the connection between speech and print, and daily phonological awareness activities were incorporated into instruction. Our speech language pathologist was and continues to be such an important member of our team in supporting this work. Our primary educators committed to consistent, daily evidence-based instructional strategies that are good for all students. Despite learning to work and teach in a new format during the pandemic, our educators have brought enthusiasm and excitement to their practice this year. Here's what one educator had to say. With this approach, we are not just focusing on the struggling readers. All students are benefiting and growing at their own pace. It's exciting because I know and I have seen that it is making a difference for my students. It was really important to ensure that educators had the materials and resources that they needed to support students. Educators indicated that current resources in the school were limited in their ability to address all components of reading. For example, decodable texts contain words that require students to use and practice their knowledge of letter, sound, and spelling patterns. These texts align with the recommendations from the Right to Read Inquiry, which emphasizes the importance of decoding and/or using sound spelling patterns to read new and unknown words. To move forward, we knew that there was a gap in our resources, so we intentionally purchased these texts so that educators could do the work that needed to be done.
Our grade two and three educators were also committed to providing solid, explicit instruction for all of their students. However, they did feel that some students would need more intensive and personalized support. When we met with teachers in grade 2 and 3 to discuss student literacy skills, we reviewed data and determined plans for support based on individual skill development. We were very intentional in matching interventions to student reading summaries so that we can ensure that the work we were doing was personalized and precise. For example, small group instruction in the area of phonological awareness was selected for students who required additional explicit instruction in this area. Lexia was assigned to students who had some foundational phonological awareness skills, but were ready for explicit instruction to support vocabulary development and high frequency words. And Empower was our intervention for a small group of grade 3 students who required more intensive instruction in the area of spelling and decoding. Over the course of the year, we continue to monitor, measure, and analyze student progress. Interventions such as Hear Builder, which is an online program that supports following directions, phonological awareness, auditory memory, and sequencing skills, was provided for some students. Small groups of students who were ready to build fluency and reading comprehension skills participated in leveled literacy intervention, and in March, we began the Strong Start Reading Program. We are fortunate to be able to access the support of dedicated volunteers who deliver this program to students who are learning their letter names, letter sounds, and some high-frequency words. At our most recent meeting with our primary educators, we reviewed data and were able to celebrate the many gains that we were seeing and determine next steps for the last 2 months of the school year. Here's another example of a class summary that an educator shared for a grade 2 class. It uses the same color coding scheme discussed in the earlier slide. Again, we see much more green. Targeted foundational skill development was supported through universal explicit instruction for all students, and also through personalized interventions provided by classroom educators, learning support teachers, and volunteers. This chart shows numbers and colors, but what does this mean for our young readers? One grade 2 student shared, "I feel good. I feel proud. I like how our teacher is teaching us. I find it easy now that we do it every day. I am a good reader." One grade 3 student shared, "When I started Empower, I struggled with reading. Now that we're almost done, I feel like a strong reader. I can read Little House on the Prairie and Goosebumps." Another grade 3 student shared, "When I started Empower, I had a hard time with reading. Now that we are almost done, I feel happy that I can read big words. I am proud of me." As we reflect on where we've been, what we've learned, and the positive impact that our work has had on our students, we recognize that we have a lot to celebrate, but also that our work is not done. As we finish the 2021-22 school year and move into next year, we will continue to learn together. We know that further direction from the Ministry of Education and the Thames Valley District School Board related to the Right to Read inquiry is forthcoming. We are well positioned and excited to continue our learning and implement evidence-based strategies and practices to support all of our students. Our focus will be on the foundational skills and components of reading that build skilled readers. We will continue to gather and analyze assessment data about these components and be responsive in providing personalized teaching and interventions as necessary to all our students. As administrators, we recognize that it will be important to simplify how educators can understand their students as readers so that all educators from kindergarten to grade 8 are able to personalize and meet the needs of all their learners. The bulletin board that you see on this slide represents concepts outlined in the Right to Read inquiry recommendations. For example, the simple view of reading, which breaks down reading down into 8 foundational components grouped into categories of word recognition and language comprehension. This bulletin board is posted outside our staff area and will continue to ground the school improvement work that we do in the area of literacy. By breaking skilled reading into foundational components, focusing our assessment on these areas, and personalizing instruction for students based on what we know about their development of decoding and language comprehension skills, we will continue to support all of our students in achieving key milestones in literacy learning. Thank you for your time and attention, and we are happy to answer any questions at this time.
Thank you for that presentation.
Thank you for that presentation.
Superintendent. Trustees, are there any questions for Superintendent Auckland, the presenters?
Yes.
Trustee Hunt.
Hi, I'm having a bit of audio trouble. Hopefully you can hear me okay. On behalf of Trustee Morrell and myself, I just wanted to thank Ms. G and Ms. Demand for coming today to share like the work of the entire team. This is a vibrant, wonderful, busy school and community, and I'm so thankful for the data-driven approach that meets all of our students where they are and helps everyone move towards success. So I'm really, really thankful for this presentation today, and I hope we can get back for a visit soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Hunt. Trustee Rahman.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. I just had a question for Principal Damon and Vice Principal G. Just considering all the instructional practice and programs and supports you've put in place this year at Wilberforce, what do you see as the next step moving forward this fall?
Thanks for your question. So we are very excited, and we absolutely want to keep the momentum going. That we've started on a really great path, and everyone is very excited about the work that we're doing. And especially at this time of year when we're starting to see the gains, it really gets that enthusiasm going. So we want to keep with that momentum because we're seeing that excitement from both educators and students in their successes. Excuse me. We really have positioned ourselves well to seamlessly continue into this work next year. We will once again, the educators will begin by establishing those essential conditions for learning, by getting to know their learners, focusing their assessment on those 8 foundational components so that they can plan whole class instruction and any individualized interventions as necessary that really are responsive to what they know about who the students are in their class. As a team, we are all really excited to dive a little bit deeper into this work and continue to learn together next year.
Thank you so much.
Are there any further questions? There being no questions, thank you again, Superintendent Auckland and your presenters. We appreciate it. And we'll move on to the approval of the agenda. Are there any amendments to the agenda? If none, we'll announce that the agenda is approved as printed. Office record. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. We regret to announce the death of Ken Schwer. He passed away on 2022, April 19th. Ken was a TSA with the Thames Valley District School Board's Information Technology Department.
We will ask for a moment of silence. Thank you, Acting Board Service Supervisor Smith. Are there any conflicts of interest? Any conflicts of interest to declare? There being none. Director's announcements from the news from the system. Director Fisher.
Thank you, Vice Chair Cuddy. Before we start this evening, I would like to acknowledge the tragic school shooting that took place this afternoon in Texas, killing 14 students and a teacher at a primary school. Any act of violence which takes place in a school is both devastating and unacceptable. On behalf of the entire Thames Valley District School Board, we want to express our deepest condolences to the grieving families and affected communities. Good evening, everyone. Tonight, I would like to shine a spotlight on the incredible accomplishments of the Saunders Secondary School community. The video you're about to see is a preview of an upcoming Saunders Proud series releasing on social media later this week, which features the school's music and drama programs, culture and equity group, enriched STEM programming for students in grade 10, and other initiatives created by and for students. Without a doubt, Saunders students have much to be proud of.
We're just like a big family. We have two classes together because it's a two-credit course. So we do dance and we do drama together. So it's really fun getting to rehearse with everyone and of course with our lovely director and choreographer. So lots of fun.
So this is actually the first year we've had a prayer room at the school.
It creates a kind of a safe environment for Muslims and a place for them to meet together and get to know each other.
This is the Indigenous Cultural Center here at Saunders.
So a lot of our kids will come if they need a space for the day or even just for a period where they want to be out of that regular space.
The STEM program here, it's like a program where we have a bunch of classes sort of in a bundle. And we get a lot of like freedom rather than different like regular high school classes.
This year is actually the first year for the Saunders Black Student Association. It was created by a lovely grade 12 student named Timna. It started to like just fill in a gap that was needed when it came to like different like equity and anti-racism issues that were filled out within the student body and a place to just discuss like black excellence and like the black identity itself.
And the cancer campaign has always been a massive thing at Saunders. It's, you know, like Timna was saying, it's a thing that brings everybody together and it like really gives you that sense of community.
SaberMart started a couple years ago where we found a need for students to be able to access basic necessities that they may or may not have had at home.
We're Saunders Proud!
May is a busy month at Thames Valley District School Board with many important recognition events taking place. At Sir George Etienne-Cartier Public School, a large display was created to celebrate both Jewish Heritage Month and Asian Heritage Month. This display board was created in a high traffic area to ensure that all staff and students would take a moment to read about the many influential individuals of both Jewish and Asian heritage who had a significant positive impact on society. On May the 17th, Thames Valley recognized International Day Against Homophobia, Transphobia, and Biphobia. To mark this important occasion, schools across the district flew the pride flag and participated in various activities. One of the ways Medway High School and ARVA recognized this display was to display the 2S LGBTQIA plus books in the library learning commons, where students were encouraged to browse and pick from the various selections. At Echo Central Public School in Elgin County, this primary student was recently celebrated for his dedication to literacy development. Evan read over 300 books and was rewarded for his hard work with a reading award. It is clear from the smile on Evan's face that he is proud of this accomplishment and loves reading. Early literacy skills are developed, supported, and targeted throughout all primary classes at Echo Central, says Principal Tracy Lynn Wells. Moving to Cedar Hollow, this grade 6 class in London was thrilled to share their recent science fair projects with friends from across the school. The pupils conducted research, created poster boards full of interesting facts about the solar system, and then invited students from all other grades to the gymnasium. The grade 6's excitement was palpable as they led their peers on a tour of the universe. At Westfield Public School in Oxford County, this grade 4-5 class in Tilsonburg conducted some unique coding lessons as part of a recent math exercise. The students started by creating codes using pencil and paper inside the classroom and then headed outside to interpret and test the codes using sidewalk chalk. Ms. DeSalvo says, who says you need to you need high tech to learn coding? At Caradoc in Mount Bridges, students in Ms. Tobias's grade 5-6 class have been having a lot of fun measuring angles during their math lessons. Most recently, they used protractors tape on their desk to illustrate how all angles in a triangle add up to 180 degrees. At Hickson Central School, students across the district were getting ready to welcome our newest learners in September. These students at Hickson were part of a team welcoming future kindergarten students to an orientation event at the school. And thank you to Principal Ann Martin for that image. Great to see track and field out and about again. Here we have an example at East Elgin and Elmer. Two teams from across Thames Valley gathered at the TD Waterhouse Stadium to compete in the 2022 Thames Valley Regional Athletics Track and Field Championships. The athletes enjoyed beautiful weather as they competed in multiple events over the course of 2 days. Congratulations to all the athletes who competed in this terrific event, and results can be viewed at www.tvra.com. Lastly, I would like to share a short video that highlights some of the amazing media coverage we've received as a school board over the last month. It's inspiring stories like these that remind us that together we are TVDSB strong.
To bring community experiences and engage students, and while they were at home, how can we make an impact in our community even if we can't physically all be there in real life together?
We got the opportunity to design a picnic table, which our school also got the opportunity to include AR into it.
To see the entire class come together for one thing and to see the impact it'll have on others is pretty satisfying. It's pretty awesome.
Like, it shows that we care about our community and not just our every man for himself.
Thank you, Vice Chair Cuddy. Those are director's announcements and news from the system for this evening.
Thank you, Director Fisher. It was really interesting presentation. I've really enjoyed the one on Saunders. Excellent. There are no chairs announcements, and there's no public input. We have three sets of board meetings to pass, and I will ask for a mover and a seconder for all three. We will handle all three separately and individually, but I will get a mover and a seconder for each one. Could I have a mover for the 2022 April 19th special board meeting, the April 26th, 2022 regular board meeting, and the 2022 May special board meeting. So again, a mover and then a seconder. Trustee Hart, thank you very much. And Trustee Yeoman for seconding. Thank you very much. For the April 19th, 2022 special board meeting, are there any amendments to the minutes? Seeing no amendments, we will consider that those minutes passed. Moving to the April 26th regular board meeting, are there any amendments to those minutes? Seeing none, we will consider those minutes passed. Going to the May 3rd, 2022 special board meeting, are there any amendments to those minutes? Seeing there are none, we will consider that all of the minutes are passed. Thank you. Business arising from minutes. Are there any business arising from the minutes? Seeing that there are none, we'll move on to the award of distinction. Recipients and nominees. So I will read the list of nominees. Lubna Della, student at Oak Ridge Secondary School. Marcy Aitken, guidance counselor at A.B. Lucas Secondary School. Nicholas Bishop, learning support teacher at Woodland Heights Public School. Leonard Boyd, teacher at W. Sherwood Forest Public School. Sherwood Fox Public School. Ron Duffy, principal at Wilford Jury Public School. Robin Glenn, social worker in attendance at A.B. Lucas Secondary School. Dan Gordon, educational assistant at John P. Robarts Public School. Sherry Moody, educational assistant at Ashley Oaks Public School. Juliana Redigonda, teacher at Southside Public School. Kip Sang, teacher at Northridge Public School. Kim Seguin, volunteer at Arthur Ford Public School. Mariana Torrens, teacher at Sir Wilfrid Laurier Secondary School. And group, Jamie Johnson, early childhood educator, and Tracy Zavitz, teacher at Old North Public School. Thank you. And now we will move to the winners. Greg Bain, secondary teacher, Westminster Secondary School.
As the transportation technology teacher and head of technology and business at Westminster Secondary School, Greg Bain has a unique ability to mentor and connect with students through hands-on learning. He shows his Westminster pride as volleyball and badminton coach and builds meaningful, encouraging relationships with his students.
Michael Berry, Vice Principal at East Elgin Secondary School. Mike Berry is an exemplary vice principal who brings positive leadership to his school community. He expresses genuine care for his students' individual well-being and believes in the importance of creating strong bonds with students, staff, and families. Mike organized a school committee for the Safe and Inclusive School Plan to support equity at East Elgin. Thank you, Mike.
Heidi Collins never hesitates to give students her time and undivided attention. Her warm smile and inviting personality set parents, guardians, staff, and students at ease the moment they enter their school. Heidi's extraordinary kindness ensures everyone can feel welcome and safe at Arthur Ford. Thank you.
Jody D. Liebeck, educational assistant, June Rose Caldwell, Caldwood Public School.
Thank you. Jody DeLiebeck is held in high regard by the staff at June Rose Caldwell Public School for her dedication to students and for her more than 20 years of work as an educational assistant. Jody promotes independence in the students she supports while providing them a safe, nurturing place to grow and learn. Jody has paved the way for both students and staff achievement thanks to her considerable efforts and strong professional relationships. Many thanks for your assistance with this. Thank you, Jody.
Tiffany Froines, secondary teacher, Montcalm Secondary School.
Thank you. Tiffany is a valued developmental education teacher whose boundless generosity has strengthened the trust of her students and their families. From helping students find accessible healthcare supports to delivering groceries to isolated families, Tiffany routinely goes above and beyond to help students overcome academic and personal barriers to success. Her peers consider her an amazing asset at Montcalm.
Allison Gamble, secondary teacher, London South Collegiate Institute.
Allison's commitment to equitable learning has resulted in increased physical education participation among female and transgendered identifying students at LSCI. She has been a pioneer in developing connections between physical education and the arts with her dance and movement programming, and has even been invited to national conferences to share her innovative teaching practices with other school boards across Canada.
Scott Grimbleby, charge custodian, Zora Highland Park Public School.
Scott is a beloved presence at Zora Highland Park, where he has built meaningful bonds with the students and staff when he greets them in the halls every day. He is a member of the Safe and Accepting Schools Committee and endeavors to make every child feel welcome, even creating coloring pages of their favorite characters and volunteering his time to teach creative art lessons. As charge custodian, Scott models what he means to be a partners in education by running initiatives that encourage students to take care of their school. Thank you, Scott.
Maggie Hagedorn, Administrative Secretary, Huron Park Secondary School.
I'm just going to pause for a moment here to express my appreciation for having the opportunity to serve on the Award of Distinction Committee. The testimonials we were given were inspiring, making the decisions quite difficult. As you've been hearing, there is much excellence in TVDSB. And another candidate here is Maggie Hagedorn, the Administrative Secretary at Huron Park Secondary School. Maggie has helped make countless memories during her 34 years at the school board, even organizing milestone school events like Huron Park's commencement and awards ceremonies. She celebrates students and encourages their growth in all areas, championing school initiatives like Grow Girls, to promote physical and mental well-being amongst students. Maggie's advocacy for students and mentorship to staff make her an invaluable part of the school community. Thank you, Maggie.
Melissa Hayter, elementary teacher, Park Hill West Williams Public School.
Trustee Hunt.
If Sean is experiencing some difficulty.
I was muted, folks. I'm very sorry about
that. No problem.
I'm reading away. I'd like to take this opportunity to honor Melissa Hayter. The staff at Park Hill West Williams call Melissa Hayter a supportive mentor, an inspiring educator, and a steadfast friend. In her role as teacher librarian, she gives of her time generously to both students and staff and makes the school library a safe space to grow and learn. Megan goes above and beyond as a member of the literacy team to help students at all levels improve their literacy skills. I'm very thankful for her contribution.
Nathan Henderson, elementary teacher, Ashley Oaks Public School.
As a teacher librarian, Nathan Henderson has transformed the Ashley Oaks Learning Commons into a vibrant learning space that encourages creative thinking and embraces curiosity about science, technology, engineering, and the arts and mechanics. With Nathan's help, students have recently enjoyed STEAM activities like robotics and coding at the Library Learning Commons. Nathan's beloved video announcements shine a spotlight on students' creativity and are the highlight of everyone's morning at Ashley Oaks.
Helen Kim, teacher on special assignment, English second language.
Over the past 2 years, Helen Kim has served as a leader in the Learning Support Services team as a teacher on special assignment. In her role, Helen supports English language learners in schools and completes initial language assessments for newcomer students. Helen has quickly become the go-to educator for her colleagues and has helped to establish the standard for the entire team and system to work towards. In addition, Helen has made a significant impact with the broader school community, ensuring an equitable outcome for all students.
And Amy Mann, elementary teacher, C.C. Carruthers Public School.
Students in Amy Mann's grade 1-2 class at C.C. Crothers Public School love her kind, fun, and respectful way of teaching. Amy puts the needs of all students first and provides a safe, welcoming, and inclusive learning and working environment for everyone at the school. She collaborates with her colleagues, school administrators, families, and community members to help her students achieve success. Destined to teach, Amy has used a trauma-based approach to make sure that each student has felt safe and encouraged throughout this pandemic.
Finley McCauley, student, College Avenue Secondary School.
Finley McCauley is a grade 11 student at College Avenue Secondary School. Finley is an important leader at CASS who always displays a positive, mature, and welcoming attitude. They have a strong commitment to inclusivity and are a trusted friend among their peers. Finley has been involved in many extracurriculars, including Freshman Frenzy, Grade 8 Open House Days, and the Rainbow Nightclub, the Pride Alliance at CASS. Finley is not only a strong advocate for fellow students and LGBTQ+ inclusion, but also a talented musician and a singer who performed as part of the grade 10 music class second place finish in the CBC Music Challenge. Finley, you're an inspiration to students everywhere.
Gary McNaughton, volunteer, Echo Central Public School.
Now I'd like to take this opportunity to recognize Gary. Gary's a well-known volunteer, not only in the school, but also within the community. And I should say that Trustee Morrell and I have seen him each time we visited Echo, either coming to or leaving the school. Gary's a highly valued volunteer at Central Public School. He's worked tirelessly to support students, most notably through Echo Central's student nutrition program, which feeds over half of the school population. In addition to his work with the breakfast program, Gary has secured several donations from community organizations to support the purchase of supports equipment and a new electronic school sign. He's also volunteered his time with the school's developmental education program. Throughout the pandemic, Gary has been an integral and positive influence on the lives of Echo students and staff throughout the community. Many thank you for his assistance.
Ann Moulton, Staffing Supervisor, Education Center.
Ann is a staffing supervisor with the Human Resources Department. Ann began working with the board 30 years ago with the Oxford Board and has grown to be an invaluable and important resource to colleagues and staff. She is someone who inspires innovation, creates a culture of acceptance, and embodies all of the commitments and values of Thames Valley District School Board. Congratulations and yawn go, Ann.
Joyce Sandham, elementary teacher, Southridge Public School.
Joyce teaches a grade 1-2 split at Southridge Public School. For more than 20 years, Joyce has been a highly respected member of the school community. As an educator, Joyce is an outstanding teacher and is able to find success with students who have not experienced success in other classrooms. As a colleague, she has a wealth of resources and insights and willingly shares her expertise and time with the entire school community. Congratulations, Joyce.
Heather Summers, elementary teacher, Lambeth Public School.
Heather Summers is a grade 8 teacher at Lambeth Public School. Heather is an amazing advocate for students, staff, and families. She's always the first to volunteer when additional tasks need to be done. She coaches teams, runs extracurricular clubs, helps out when duties need to be covered, and gives up her free time to cover classes when needed. Heather is a natural when it comes to making people around her feel valued and important, and this is reflected in her relationships with students and staff. The entire Lambeth School community is grateful to have Heather as part of their educator team.
Carolyn Weens, elementary teacher, Northridge Public School.
Carolyn is an elementary teacher currently working at Northridge Public School. She's a dedicated and passionate teacher who adapts lessons and teaching plans to ensure each student can experience success. Whether she is teaching her class, coaching intermediate or junior students, organizing school events or field trips, or volunteering her time for school and community events, students are at the center of her decision-making. Carolyn is an exemplary educator and a valued member of the Northridge school community.
Melissa Zylstra, Educational Assistant, Southside Public School.
Melissa loves to work in the kindergarten program. In addition to being an experienced and knowledgeable resource for her colleagues, Melissa is an education assistant mentor, a member of the school's first aid team. She coaches cross country and is often the person who administration will call on due to her ability to know what each student needs to turn their day around in the right direction. Melissa is firm but respectful, and all students at Southside thrive under her supervision. Congratulations, Melissa.
Thank you to all the nominees and to all the winners of the 2022 awards. The trustees and I used to really enjoy going to the award ceremony and meeting everyone, and I'm sorry we can't do that. I hope at some stage we'll be able to get back to that again. Thank you again, and congratulations to the winners and to the nominees.
Vice Chair Kadi, we have one more group. Their picture is up on our screens at the moment.
I am so sorry. I apologize.
That's all good. This is Trustee Smith.
Thank you, Trustee Smith. Jennifer Clark, Judy, sorry, I'll let you go ahead, Trustee Smith. Excuse me.
Thank you. I can see this wonderful picture in front of me of Jennifer Clark, Judy Hutchison-Fife, Terry Johnson, and Laura Klustra, our team of educational assistants who provide a safe, welcoming, and inclusive environment for students at Arthur Vodin Secondary School. This outstanding team has gone above and beyond over the last 2 years, providing resources and experiences that meet each student's strengths and needs. As individuals, each one of them is hardworking and caring. Due to their commitment to their work, their students have continued to experience success throughout the pandemic and beyond. Thank you to the group.
Once again, thank you to all the nominees and the recipients, and great work. And we look forward to meeting you all at some stage, at some event. Thank you. We'll move on to the student trustee update. Student trustee Thassa Skumar.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. Our student trustee update this month consists mostly of the nearing conclusion of my year-long mental health project. As we saw in the London Free Press article, which was featured in the director's announcements, much of the feedback is collected by our student senators at each of the schools, and in the next week, feedback will come in and a final report will begin to be drafted for presentation to the mental health leads at the school board. As well, the incoming student trustees are well on their way to being transitioned, and myself and the incomings are attending the AustAECO annual general meeting this week to continue to help them transition into their role. That will be my update this meeting.
Thank you, Trustee Thassa Skumar. Are there any questions for the trustee at this stage? If not, we will move on. Trustee Subani.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. This month, we also had our first in-person SAC meeting, and getting to meet our senators in person really allowed us to connect much more efficiently. There was a clear difference in engagement. We collected valuable input regarding the way we have ran SAC meetings throughout this year. Senates advised the student trustees regarding the relation building and creating a consistent role for the Senates, and many other variables. We're very excited to take this feedback to our incomings to keep maintaining progress. Senates also reported that the sports and club recovery after the pandemic, it seems although sports have recovered quite efficiently, clubs are struggling to get back up in some schools. Senates believe that this might be due to the lack of initiative needed for clubs while sports is dependent on staff. A focus on more student leadership and initiative would be beneficial. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Subani. Student Trustee Whiteye.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. So I will be updating you guys on last month's May 5th dress day turnout. As for the schools with the higher Indigenous populations, there was a great turnout of students and staff wearing red and taking in awareness of missing and murdered Indigenous women. I hope this can reach all high schools in the future. Considering this was the first time of an awareness campaign, I feel there is room for improvement, as there always is when spreading awareness and information. I made stickers for the students within Saunders who are not wearing red but wish to show their support, and we gave them out for free but were taking donations if they could. We raised $187 for the Xiaowenong Woman Shelter, which is a safe space for Indigenous women and is affiliated with Atlosa. Taking what I learned from this year and some new ideas I have for the following years, I plan to work closely with the upcoming Indigenous student trustee, Liza Nimham, to make the transition smooth and create more awareness for the upcoming years. Thank you.
Thank you, Student Trustee Whiteye. Are there any questions for any of the student trustees? I want to thank all three of you for the work you've done this year. It's really been exceptional. I know we've got more to do, but I've really enjoyed working with you. And you guys are so bright. And it's just, it's gratifying to see students with so much interest. Thank you, all three of you. Thank you. Reports from administration. Let me see. Yes, I'm sorry. Superintendent Skinner, thank you.
Thank you, and through the chair. Good evening. We are very pleased to provide you with a second progress update for this school year on our work in the area of equity as it relates to the board motions of June 2020 and the draft equity action plan, which was shared last spring. Equity continues to remain a key priority in our strategic plan and our board operational plan, and is foundational to the work in all areas of the organization. It is our responsibility and the moral imperative to enhance equity, inclusion, and respect for all students and staff, as well as families in Thames Valley. As you will recall, the June 2020 board motion was comprised of four essential mandates. These include, number one, community engagement and the opportunity that this allows in understanding lived experiences of those who have been historically excluded and have experienced disparity in our schools. Number two, the development of an equity and inclusion advisory committee, which includes students, community members, trustees, administration, as well as parents and caregivers. Number three, commitment to the exploration of training, including anti-racism and anti-oppression training. And finally, number four, to explore the practice of collecting disaggregate data and reporting this back to the board on issues or concerns. There has been tremendous work that has been done by various departments and portfolios at Thames Valley, and we are pleased to update you on a few key equity initiatives across various portfolios that are connected to the draft equity action plan and support these four mandates of the June 2020 motion. We will begin this evening discussing community engagement. Over the last several months, our focus has been to engage in regular consultation with specific community members and groups to address system needs. We will highlight a few of these this evening, which include the development of the anti-sex trafficking protocol, the family well-being community workshop collaboration, the Two Puente program, and the anti-Islamophobia workshops and community collaboration. The anti-sex trafficking protocol was developed with over 20 community partners across various sectors, including child welfare, community service providers who support individuals impacted by gender-based violence, Indigenous service providers, community planning tables, and police services. Atlosa Family Healing Services played a key role in the development of this protocol, as we know Indigenous women and girls are especially vulnerable, representing 50% of those being trafficked. The Family Wellbeing Community Workshop Collaboration is a partnership with the London District Catholic School Board and over 20 agencies representing all three regions of Thames Valley District School Board. This initiative has utilized extensive community engagement in order to provide workshops throughout the calendar year for parents and caregivers on various topics related to mental health and well-being, which are directly impacted by issues related to equity. As part of Mental Health Week in May, this collaborative group released an annual schedule of workshops. The Tu Puente program is another multi-board partnership to serve migratory Low German Mennonite students who reside in both Ontario and Mexico. We are working with a Low German Mennonite support worker who is directly doing outreach to engage families while creatively rethinking how we access these families, respecting their traditions and beliefs. Through ongoing consultation with a variety of partners, we continue to work with and take lead from our Muslim community members and agencies to address Islamophobia within our community through resource development and professional development workshops. This partnership is especially critical as we approach the June 6th commemoration of the London terrorist attack. These examples of partnerships demonstrate the importance of connecting with community members and agencies with the knowledge and expertise of students' interlocking identities and lived experiences to inform work with students, staff, and families in Thames Valley. The second mandate of the board motion highlights the development of an Equity and Inclusion Advisory Committee, which was established in November of 2020. Additionally, the Student Equity and Inclusion Advisory Committee was formed in November of 2021, which I will speak to in a few moments. The Equity and Inclusion Advisory Committee played a key role in the development of the anti-racism training that was delivered to all schools on March the 4th Professional Development Day by sharing their lived experiences as well as ideas on how to best address racism in schools. This conversation served as the basis for the content that was developed for this critical learning for all school staff. This committee continues to play a critical role in our work in the area of equity by providing valuable advice and insight from the unique perspective of each of the members. The Student Equity and Inclusion Advisory Committee continues to meet biweekly and has been engaged in providing student voice to equity initiatives such as the creation of the Black History Month Educator Resources, the review of the School Resource Officer Program, the School Naming Review Committee, and the results from the Every Student Belongs survey. Members of the student committee have also been invited to join the community-based Equity and Inclusion Advisory Committee for continued dialogue, student voice, and meaningful connection opportunities. The third mandate of the motion from June 2020 speaks to training and requests that Thames Valley commit to including anti-racism and anti-oppression training. System and school leaders have continued to participate in equity training with Kojo Institute, where they have developed an understanding about foundational equity and anti-racism concept, learned about how inequities appear in education, and took part in discussions about their role in terms of equity-informed leadership. Upon completion of this training, participants took time to reflect on their learning. Many participants identified a need to continue their learning in the area of equity, and as such, we are exploring additional training opportunities for staff with Kojo Institute that will address specific topics and practical implementation. Let's listen to a few staff voices as they reflect on their learning in the area of equity and what they have committed to action through their leadership.
I can commit to practicing and modeling equity in all the schools I visit with the staff and students I encounter and to embed this into the PD that I create and share with other educators. I sincerely believe and know this is the foundation to all learning.
I will encourage proactive ways to engage all stakeholders in my school community about challenges that face our school arising from inequities. I will encourage staff to develop culturally relevant lessons for students so all students have the opportunity to see themselves in their learning. I will encourage an equitable and inclusive school environment where all voices can be heard.
We need to continue the training and placing this work at the forefront. Examine our organization for our own systems of racism and oppression.
As you just heard, system and school leaders are committed to ongoing self-reflection and discussion on topics related to bias, oppression, and anti-racism. As a school board, we have continued our intentional focus on professional learning related to equity, anti-racism, and human rights in all areas of the organization. An entire day's learning for all staff in March was built on a foundation of cultural safety and mental health and was dedicated to equity, anti-racism, and culturally relevant and responsive pedagogy. On this day, all school staff received mandatory training related to the new guidelines on the non-use of racial and other slurs and epithets. Learning was not only focused on staff's professional obligation related to the non-use of slurs, but also outlined tools and strategies to assist staff in supporting students in situations where slurs may have been used. Participants in this Professional Development Day have continued to engage in voluntary follow-up sessions to consolidate learning and further explore the application of anti-racist and culturally relevant and responsive practices in schools and classrooms. The last mandate in the June 2020 motion speaks to collecting disaggregate data by school, grade, race, disability, sex, gender, and socioeconomic status, and then reporting back to the board. As you know, during 2020-21 school year, Thames Valley launched the Every Student Belongs survey, which was developed and administered to collect identity-based data from students in kindergarten to grade 12. Our research and assessment department has processed and begun to analyze the survey data. Opportunities for discussion of reporting summary results are being shared with various stakeholder groups. We look forward to using this data in the new school year to better understand students' lived experiences and backgrounds and identify specific focus areas for our work. I will now turn things over to Assistant Principal Doriana Rosati.
Sorry to interrupt, Superintendent Praveen, and Andrew, before you begin, we have a special guest here, and it's time sensitive, so we'll need to take a few minutes to have the presentation. Is that okay with everyone? It will take 15 minutes, I believe, or so, roughly. So I'd like to present Christine Tembavaganza. Christine is, I'll let you introduce yourself, Christine. Come up. Thank you. My apologies. Thank you.
Are you able to advance? Thank you. So good evening through the chair. Hello, I'm Christine Tamawongsa, the current chair of the Special Education Advisory Committee of the Thames Valley District School Board. I'm here this evening, if you could go to the next slide, I'm here this evening to present on a motion that was made by SEAC at our April 11th meeting and has been forwarded on to the board for action. It's in the agenda package for this evening, and on the screen in front of you is the preamble to the motion. The important parts of this are that the timeliness of the matter is due to it being nearing and approaching to the end of the term of the board, and SEAC's term of office coincides with that. So SEAC has been reviewing for the last year our handbook and has made the following recommendations for the board on establishing process and guidelines for the appointment of SEAC members, which we hope you will be able to implement in time for the new term. As I'm sure you're aware, SEAC is a statutory committee of the board under Ontario Regulation 46497, and the committee recognizes that the responsibility for appointments to SEAC lies with the Board of Trustees. In making these recommendations, the SEAC Handbook Working Group reviewed the membership guidelines of other board SEACs, the PAC on SEAC Handbook, and the intent and direction of the regulation through consultation with staff. And accordingly, we are making the following recommendations. If you could advance to the next slide. So there's six parts to the motion. I'll go over each one, but I won't read everything to you right now. They will come up again later in the presentation. If you advance to the next slide. The sixth of the parts of the motion is that the SEAC Handbook Working Group have the opportunity to present to the board on this issue, and that's why I'm here this evening. So to have a background for understanding SEAC membership, it's important that we all have a picture of the current composition of SEAC. So currently, we have 8 members of local associations. Under the regulation, any school board can have up to 12. We have 3 trustee members, as specified under the regulation. Currently, Chair Pizzolatto, Trustee Yeoman, Trustee Moore are serving. We also, at this time, have 6 additional members. Under the regulation, school boards have the option to appoint 1 or more additional members, and we currently have 6. And we do not have anyone serving in the First Nations representative voting seat at this present time. Staff attend SEAC meetings, but they are there as a resource to support the work of SEAC, and they are non-voting. They are not members of SEAC. So in the process of examining the current SEAC handbook to see what improvements we could make going into a new term, we identified a few areas of concern. And we have previously referred to the board the matter of the First Nations representation. And we understand consultations are ongoing at this time with the First Nations communities with which Thames Valley has education service agreements. So we await hearing more from the communities about how they would like to address that issue going forward. However, there are other issues which we considered second priority after that one, and they're part of this recommendation. And because they relate to membership, we're bringing them forward to the board as recommendations for the board to act under their responsibility in that matter. So the major issues in general are that in Thames Valley, we currently have no provision to fill vacancies during the term. So you heard me say that under the regulation, there could be up to 12 local associations. I don't believe during the current term we have ever had 12. We did at one time have 9. Technically, as of right this moment, we maybe only have 7, but you're going to deal with that tonight, and it will be back to 8. But that process for dealing with vacancies during the terms in Thames Valley is not standardized. It's not documented anywhere. There's some past practices, but some of us are going on memory of what those are, which is not a good way to run an organization of this scale. So currently in Thames Valley, there's no limit on additional members, and it's not clear how members would be selected if more organizations nominated members, other than that the power to do so resides with the board. So the regulation that establishes SEAC as statutory committee, OREG 46497, it sets the minimum requirements for membership and operations. It defines the role of SEAC and our responsibilities, and it defines clearly what it means by local association. And that's the definition that's on the screen there. And grasping that is important to understand why there's 2 categories of membership. So under the regulation, local association means specifically an association or organization of parents that operates locally within the area of jurisdiction of a board. It can't be affiliated with any association or organization of professional educators, but it does need to be incorporated and operate throughout Ontario to further the interests and well-being of one or more groups of exceptional children and adults. PACON-SEAC is the Provincial Parent Association Advisory Committee on SEAC, and it's made up of members from across the province who serve on many SEACs at many different boards. It has great resources on its website, including a handbook on effective SEAC practices, and some of the recommendations I've included in the presentation that you have in your package come from that source. And chief among those is that boards develop policies for SEAC that clearly define the number of additional members and the criteria that will be used to select additional members. That policy should clearly indicate that the number of additional members is not to exceed the number of local association members, and it describe or the attributes or connections required for additional members of SEAC. So while the regulation defines local association, it just describes additional members very vaguely. So PAC would recommend that boards of trustee consider appointing as additional members representatives from community agencies or organizations, either
that support groups of children with exceptionalities that are not otherwise represented by one of the local associations putting forward an application to be nominated and appointed to SEAC, or they support one or more groups of children with exceptionalities, but for some reason don't meet the criteria for a local association. And the most common situation that arises is there are local associations doing very good work in our communities, very applicable to SEAC, but they may not be incorporated. So they could be appointed to a SEAC by a board of trustees, but only as an additional member, not as a local association. So the first part of the motion is that the board establish protocols for appointments to SEAC to ensure that the membership is diverse, representative of all exceptionalities, and in compliance with the current regulations. For that purpose, PAC on SEAC recommends an application form, and that has been past practice at TVDSB. In your package, there's this presentation, and then there's Appendix A to this presentation. And that is the application form and cover letter that were used in 2018 by Thames Valley. And there's also a suggestion from the SEAC Working Group for a second page that could be added to the application to gather more information from potential nominees about their experience and interest in serving on SEAC. Second part of the motion is that the board consider measures to ensure that until there are 12 allowable local parent association members, the board treats the difference from 12 as vacancies to be filled within the term. So as I mentioned earlier, during this entire term, we have not had 12. So the board could have been continuing to recruit, to solicit nominations and have a call open for membership on SEAC. And as we just interrupted a presentation on equity, I think it's pretty obvious why that would be a more equitable practice to get more representation and more voices involved. So it hasn't been clear, consistent, or transparent how Thames Valley would deal with new appointments or new applications that might come forward during the term. So we would suggest standardizing that and documenting what that procedure is. Chiefly, we'd like to see it advertised on the board website on an ongoing basis. On this slide are some effective practices from PAC on SEAC regarding dealing with vacancies. We don't need to go through this detail this evening, but whatever the board decides to do on this matter, whoever is charged with establishing Thames Valley's practices, policy and procedure, whatever the board determines we need, these are some of the areas that need to be considered in detail. The third part of the motion is that the board establish voting member requirements so that local parent association members form a voting majority on SEAC, as they currently do, but that would involve setting a maximum number of the other members, including members at large, partner organizations, additional members. Some boards in Ontario have no additional members. Some have clear limits to the number that can be appointed. Some boards have community partner agencies, which have valuable input to provide to SEAC, but they have them serve as resources, not voting members. So that would be very equivalent to the relationship between the SEAC members and our own staff currently. So there's different practices across the province. This is very much in the board's purview to determine what they think is the best fit for TVDSB. The working group and SEAC as a whole, as I said, have been discussing this for a year, and we would recommend the approach of setting a small maximum number of additional members and specifying that they should be organizations who support students with exceptionalities and that a preference should be given to any exceptionalities not otherwise covered by the local association members. A total of 6 could be a potential number to consider, but there's a lot of considerations to take into place with that. One of those being what the future expressed wishes of the First Nations communities are around their representation. So the regulation only allows or affords for one specific First Nations seat,
but the Board of Trustees could certainly, within their purview, appoint any number of representatives to represent the First Nations communities under the additional member category. So sections 4 and 5 are that the board engage in an open, transparent, and respectful period of advertising the call for SEAC representatives prior to each election cycle, and whenever any of the allowable 12 local association seats are vacant. Also that the board establish a transparent application process for filling seat vacancies during the term. We would recommend that as a statutory committee of the board, that SEAC be featured more prominently on the board's website and that any seat vacancies be posted until they're filled. Again, this slide is a list of recommendations that boards could use, and we do many of these things, but it's a checklist to remind us going into an election cycle of effective practices for soliciting nominations for local association members. And the better we do that, this, the better the equity and diversity of the representation on SEAC will be. So it's not something to be taken lightly given the board's priorities. So on the action summary slide, I've listed the key things that we, just to sum up the motions and kind of simplify it. So the areas to be addressed are the appointment process, standardizing that, documenting that, that's the application form, et cetera. We have the SEAC handbook that can be updated to include these pieces. There's also the SEAC section of the board website. There's the whole area of filling vacancies and calling for nominations. We need to clarify what TVDSB's practices are and make sure that's clearly documented. Appointment criteria. So working together, we should establish guiding principles to complement the regulatory requirements with SEAC advice. And again, that should be in the SEAC handbook and on the website. And additional members, this is the most important part for the board to consider, since it is their responsibility, is to consider setting a limit through a resolution of the board. It would not seem appropriate, we did not think at SEAC, for that to be anybody but the trustees who would do that. And of course, we support any decision of the trustees to refer implementation of these recommendations to the staff, SEAC, or any other committees of the board as they deem appropriate. Finally, there's a target timeline. Because we know the election date is set for October 24th, we can work backwards from that. Period for soliciting membership, if we look at what was done 4 years ago, it could be something like September 15th to October 31st. October 31st is the usual deadline. 15th would be about 5 days later than it started 4 years ago, but there's quite a bit of work to be done by staff and by CX, so that might work just fine. But in order for us to meet that, we should have any of these changes regarding SEAC's practice, or regarding Thames Valley's practices around populating SEAC, ready to be shared publicly by September 15th. So the recommendation from SEAC would be that we would need decisions from the trustees on these matters no later than June 30th of this year. So once the election happens, the Board of Trustees appoints the new SEAC in November of 2022, and we have the target date of a full upgrade to the SEAC handbook being ready by December 2022 for the new SEAC members to benefit from as orientation. The final slide has some references that we used to put the presentation together, which you might want to refer to in your package. And I'm glad to take any questions that I could, if I can clarify anything that was confusing. I know it's a lot to absorb.
Thank you very much. And Trustee Moore, I owe you an apology. I didn't read my notes, and you were going to make the opening introduction. So I will turn this over to you with my apologies. Thank you.
That's quite all right. I think Christine's done an excellent job. Thank you so much for the presentation. You put a lot of complicated information into some a lot easier to digest slides, and I do appreciate it.
That was a challenge.
It looked like a challenge. I know how much of a challenge it is, but I think you've made clear what SEAC is trying to do here, which is the key piece, right? What problem are we trying to solve? I think that's really clear, and I really appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Trustee Moore. And I'd like to remind everyone that even though Trustee Moore is a relatively new trustee in the past few months, you've been involved with SEAC for how many years? Don't even want to talk about it, right?
So, okay. You're making it sound like longer than it was, but sort of peripheral for a while. And then I was, previous to this role, I had been sitting on SEAC, which created a little bit of an issue when I quit suddenly.
Well, we appreciate all your effort and your time you spent on this. And I'm going to ask if there's any questions from the trustees, and then I'm going to turn it back to you to put the motion on the floor. Okay. Are there any questions from trustees on this presentation? Trustee Rahman.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. First, thank you for the presentation this evening. I really appreciated it and the in-depth report. As well to SEAC for the work they're doing on the trustee handbook. I understand these meetings are long, the handbook subcommittee, and very extensive conversation is taking place. So thank you for that work that you're doing. So I have a couple questions this evening. The first I wanted to start with is regarding the timeline and the June 30th date. My understanding is that you're looking for this membership policy to be in place by that June 30th date. So my question is, first to you and then to administration about the timing of that and whether or not that's a timeline that you think that we can meet. Thank you.
My answer would be that the June 30th is a really outside date. Sooner is better for the work that needs to be done. I think with a June 30th date, there's going to be some people, both staff and SEAC volunteers, doing some work over the summer to get the pieces together to be ready to do the soliciting of members by no later than mid-September.
Thank you. And if I may ask the question of Superintendent Canham around the date of June 30th and whether or not that was a date that could work with administration as well. Thank you.
Superintendent Canham, are you able to respond to that question from Trustee Rahman, please?
I most certainly am, and through you, Chair. The June 30th date is a date that SEAC has identified for the Board of Trustees to make a decision on the recommendations, with a further date of September the 15th for the Board and SEAC to develop a process around those recommendations. I think the latter date is certainly something that is attainable. I think the June 30th date would be subject to feedback from the Board of Trustees this evening. It would be a challenging date for us to meet. Thank you.
Yes, Trustee Rahman.
Thank you, and I have a second question, if that's
yes,
okay.
Please.
Thank you so much. My second question relates to conflict of interest noted in the package and on the application previous that was included. I guess it's more of a question and comment. So my concern was that when reading it, it seemed as though the question around conflict of interest for a member of SEAC is more extensive than the conflict of interest required of a member of the Board of Trustees. So in our Board of Trustees conflict of interest, we only look at pecuniary interest. So in the report and within the package and application, it looked as if there was consideration for more than pecuniary interest. So I just want to clarify what the nature and the meaning of conflict of interest is within that package. Thank you.
So I'm not an expert on conflict of interest. I would actually very much like SEAC to receive a presentation with advice on conflict of interest. I will say that in my couple of decades of involvement with SEAC, both at the school board and in the province of Ontario at the provincial level, we need to be careful since the role of SEAC is to give the trustees advice on any matter pertaining to special education and the programming and everything to do with that. We need to be very careful that the membership of SEAC doesn't have any conflict of interest with any financial contracts between, for example, the board and the employer of the member. So that would be one example that comes to mind.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Trustee Moore, I don't see any further questions. Would you like to put the motion on the floor?
I believe there is a slide.
Oh, yes, excuse me, Christine. You could return to your seat if you don't mind. Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you for the presentation. Trustee Moore?
So I guess my question is, are we okay to go ahead with this even though the date that's requested is sort of not clear? We're fine to just go ahead with the motion?
We're good to go ahead. Thank you.
Okay, so then the board motion that I'm proposing is that staff review the SEAC recommendations in the SEAC report of 2022 May 24th and develop a policy and procedure for a SEAC appointment process of filling of vacancies to be referenced in the SEAC handbook, that they seek input from the SEAC committee and present the policy to the board for consideration by the 2022 September board meeting.
Thank you. Do we have a seconder for Trustee Moore's motion?
Trustee Smith will second it.
Thank you, Trustee Smith. Trustee Moore, would you like to speak to your motion, please?
I think Christine's presentation covered most of it, but I'm happy to answer any questions.
The seconder, Trustee Smith, would you like to speak to the motion?
No, thank you. The people who spoke before me are far more knowledgeable. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else if this is debate? Oh, yes, Trustee Roman. Roman, thank you.
Thank you, and through you, and on debate. My thoughts around the motion are just, first, I'm thankful that we're having this discussion, excuse me, and that this work has been done from the SEAC Handbook Committee and the membership. I was able to attend the last meeting and heard some really great discussion as well. My question relates to where the Policy Working Committee would come in on the process related to the motion. So I guess I'm debating whether or not there should be something in the motion to refer this to Policy Working Committee. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Rahman. Trustee Hunt.
Through you, Chair, I'm thankful for the presentation, but I do have some issues with the wording of the motion. I think in line or similar to what Trustee Rahman has mentioned, in that it blurs the line of governance in that the policy committee sets policy and staff develop procedure from that policy. And this motion directs staff to develop both the policy and the procedure. So I'm not certain how this gets operationalized.
Okay, and we need to address Trustee Rahman's question as well. Trustee Moore.
Just noting that those are excellent comments and I'm open to friendly amendments.
Trustee Rahman, did you want to take us? Do you want to go at this?
Thank you, and through you, Chair. So Trustee Moore is better at the amendments than I am. But I would amend to develop a policy and procedure to say that policy working committee develop a policy and procedure.
Acting Corporate Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. If I may, before we get into amending, just provide sort of some details on process, and then if you still feel that you need to make the amendment. Thank you. So we would still follow the regular operative norms that we use for developing policies and procedures. So stakeholders would still be consulted, which would be policy working, SEAC. It would still follow the normal process of going to policy working, asking for input, going out for public input. We would still follow all those normal steps. And before it came to board, it would still need to go to the September policy working committee to have that recommendation to come to board. So it would still follow all those normal steps. You would still see the procedure and provide input. And as our regular process. So I don't it's up to you, obviously, if you want to amend the motion, but that would be part of the process that we would normally follow.
Trustee Gonzalez.
Just a question in relation to that potential amendment and to what corporate supervisor has indicated. Is it realistic to go through the process and present the policy to the board for consideration by the September 2022 meeting?
Thank you, and through you, Chair. We did check that. So the policy working meeting in September is September 13th. So that would provide us time to receive feedback from the committee and make those changes prior, any changes prior to it coming to the board table.
Trustee Rahman, did you want to?
Thank you, and through you, Chair. So I'm comfortable if the motion is as stands, if the work is going through policy working committee as well and following the normal process that we typically would. I'm fine with keeping it as is. I do agree that what I heard from the presenter was a bit of that this needs to come back for the board to do the work. And I just want to ensure that we use our mechanisms to do that work. So that was why I was saying to policy working committee. Thanks.
Trustee Moore.
So I would say if we take the amendment out, that as long as it's reflected in the minutes, that what the actual process is, I think that takes care of it.
Okay. Trustee Hunt, are you okay with that?
I'm not able to support the motion the way it is, but I'll leave it to others to decide to amend it or not.
Okay, thank you. Any further debate at this time? Oh, Trustee Yeoman.
I have a logistics question. May I ask that? I have a logistics question. Could I ask that? And I'm not sure if it would go to Director Fisher or who would answer this. But if this motion were passed, do we presently have the staff capacity to put this motion in place, or are there any considerations that you'd like to speak to?
Thank you for the question, Trustee Yeoman, and through you, Vice Chair Cuddy. I will defer to Superintendent of Education with the Portfolio of Special Education, Canham, to answer that question.
Thank you for the question, and through you, Chair, to Trustee Owen's question, yes, we do have the staff capacity that over the summer months we could be working on a policy and procedure that we could draft and bring to the policy to PwC at its first meeting in September. There would also be an opportunity to consult with SEAC in advance of the policy coming to the board. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Yeoman. And any further debate? Trustee Hunt.
Just another question of clarification. So it would go to Policy Working Committee September 13th, after which the Policy Working Committee would approve the policy portion, and then it would go out for 30 days or 60 days of public input, as it typically would in my experience as a member of the policy committee. Does that still allow time to make a decision and develop an appropriate procedure, I guess, before the end of the term is the goal? I'm not sure who to direct that to other than whoever's currently maybe supporting policy working committee.
Trustee Moore.
I'm not sure if this is out of order, but I'm sure I'll hear quickly if it is. Would the problem be solved if we said that staff and policy working group review the SEAC recommendations? Would that give the policy working group advanced time to be reviewing the policy instead of waiting, or review the recommendations and start to get some of the work done instead of waiting for staff to finish and then ping-ponging it back and forth?
Trustee Rahman, did you want to comment on this?
Thank you, through you, Chair. I would say that that's a question for acting
Corporate Supervisor Smith. Thank you.
Thank you, and through the chair. First to Trustee Hunt's question. It's up to the trustees how long you would like it to go out for public input. So it could be 7 days, 14 days. And then you'd have to prioritize whether you wanted longer public input and have a motion to extend the September deadline to October, or whether you wanted to keep the September deadline and shorten the length of time that it's out for public input. And sorry, to Trustee Moore's question, I think it would be more appropriate to follow our proper process that we have in place.
Trustee Roman.
Thank you, through you. Trustee Hunt brings up a dilemma for us in that we do need to consider the length of public input and the deadline and timeliness of this matter. I agree with what Trustee Moore was trying to do to send it to Policy Working Committee sooner so that we might be able to back up that timeline a little bit so that we give ourselves adequate time to review before the 13th and get it out for public input. I guess my question would be to Superintendent Canham, if there's a way, I'm not sure how far along in this process you may be already, is there a way that this could get moved up so that we could address this before the September 13th date? I know that's leaving very limited time so that we could have ample time for public input. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for the question, and through the chair, that is certainly something that we could look at. I'd have to consult with Acting Corporate Supervisor Smith as to when the next PWC meeting is, and we may potentially be able to have a draft policy in place before the end for PWC's review before the end of this academic year.
Thank you, Superintendent Canham. Any further debate? Okay, so we'll take this to a vote. Should I have it? Yes, Trustee Roman, thank you.
Thank you, and through you, just for information, the next PWC meeting is June 14th. So if it was possible to meet the June 14th timeline in order that we could make this happen in time, I think then that would be something to work from. Thank you.
Okay, Superintendent Canham, is that okay, the June 14th?
Thank you for the question. It will be very, as I look at the calendar, it would be very difficult with that short of a timeline to be able to develop fully executed policy that would be I'd be comfortable bringing to PWC.
Okay, we need to find a solution fairly quickly here. So, should I just come up with a date and we work with that one? Trustee Moore.
This is maybe a question for Superintendent Canham. What happens to our timelines if we move later rather than earlier, if we go to that October board meeting instead of the September 27th board meeting? What does that look like?
Thank you for the question, and through the chair, it would be staff's perspective that moving to the October board meeting would be a more reasonable timeline. It would certainly give us an opportunity to develop a more fulsome policy and then ultimately the accompanying procedure, and as such would give us an opportunity to have two PWC meetings and an opportunity for public input prior to it coming to the board. It also still would have a process in place before the selection of the new term of members for SEAC. Thank you.
Trustee Moore.
So then do I amend my motion to
yes.
say the instead of September, remove September 27th and add October? I haven't thought that far ahead yet, so I don't have an actual date.
Can we
October 29th?
25.
We'll strike September and insert October.
Strike and insert. I knew that. Thank you, Lori.
Thank you. That's an amendment to the motion. So we'll need a seconder for that. Thank you, Trustee Gonzalez. Pardon? And we have debate on this. Trustee Pizzolatto.
Thank you. I'm not in support of the October 25th timeframe. Is there any way that PwC can meet like in August or in the summer sometime? And I'm asking Acting Corporate Supervisor Smith.
Thank you, and through the chair, I don't know that the staff would be here over the summer or with holidays that you'd be able to have all your staff available if the committee were to meet in August.
Any further debate? Yes, Trustee Roman.
Thank you, and through you. The revised date, the only concern I have is with the target timeline that was provided to us this evening. Just making sure that we could meet the period for soliciting members. If the date is that we don't actually confirm the procedure and the policy till October 25th, then what would our advertising period timeline be for new SEAC members? And how does that relate to when we appoint new members in November? Does it give us an ample window for the recruitment and appointment? And given that the whole presentation was around increasing membership, I think having more time to go out to members and potential members is of the utmost importance. So I'm trying to find a way as well to find a compromise. But I want to make sure that we're mindful of what the end target was, which was to increase membership. Thank you.
Any further debate at this time? Seeing no further debate, we will call this motion to a vote. All those in favor of supporting this motion, please raise your hands and raise them high so we could get a count. Yeah. Should we reread the motion?
No, just the amendment.
Yes. Can you should we just reread the amendment? That we've changed the date from September to October.
That staff review the SEAC recommendations in the SEAC report of 2022, May 24. And develop a policy and procedure for a SEAC appointment process and filling of vacancies to be referenced in the SEAC handbook. Seek input from the SEAC committee and present the policy to the board for consideration by the 2022 October 25th board meeting.
Okay, I'm sorry. My apologies. We're just at the point of striking September and inserting October 25th. So we'll vote on that. We'll vote on the amendment to the motion. So all those in favor of the amendment to the motion of October 25th, 2022, raise your hands, please. Please put your hands down. Those opposed to the amendment changing the date, please raise your hands.
Chair, I'm sorry to interrupt. Did you see my hand?
I did not. Sorry. Okay. Thank you, Trustee Rahman. I see it. Roddick, I see it now. Thank you. Yes. Sorry. Could you raise your hands again, those that are opposed to the change in dates? The amendment is carried. So we'll go back to the main motion as amended. Any further debate on the motion? As amended, thank you. Any further debate? OK. Okay, seeing none, we'll vote on this motion. Those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand and raise them high so we can count. Thank you, and please lower your hands. Those opposed to the motion, everybody lower your hand, please. Everybody opposed to the motion, please raise your hand. Okay, that motion is carried. Thank you. Thank you very much. I apologize for the interruption. Superintendent Skinner and Acting Human Rights and Equity Advisor Marlowe, I do apologize for that. And we'll now return to your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll just get our place sorted out. Perfect. This was where I had just left off, and we were referring to this collection of disaggregate data, which refers to the fourth mandate of the June 2020 motions brought forward by the trustees. So I'm pleased to turn things over to System Principal Doriana Rosati at this point.
Thank you, Superintendent Skinner. At this time, we are pleased to speak to a few key equity initiatives across various portfolios that are connected to the draft equity action plan and support the mandate of the June 2020 motion. With respect to goal one, which is affirming identities, there has been tremendous work done by various departments and portfolios in Thames Valley to affirm the identities of students and staff. We would like to highlight a collaborative initiative between Thames Valley and Brescia University College titled Brescia Bold. The Brescia Bold program is a unique collaboration between Weeble Center for Adult Education and Brescia College aimed at providing programming for specific adult women who have the potential to pursue a post-secondary pathway yet have not seen the possibilities within themselves. Starting in September 2022, students will be eligible to attend the campus while earning their Ontario Secondary School diploma and also earn a first-year university interdisciplinary course called Brescia Bold. This course is tailored for women to encourage a journey of self-discovery as well as promoting research skills and competencies for success in universities. Students gain a deep understanding of how to lead with authenticity and purpose. As well, several opportunities designed to affirm students' various interlocking identities and learning opportunities continue to be provided through the release of school and classroom resource guides. These guides contain curriculum connections, model lesson plans, supplementary resources, and staff professional learning information related to a variety of topics. Most notably, recent guidelines were developed to affirm Ramadan and the International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. The Library Services team has also launched a cross-portfolio, culturally relevant and responsive library learning initiative, which is engaging a number of Thames Valley schools in collaborative inquiries. These collaborations delve into creative and reflective ways to support more diverse representation and voice in the resources, physical environments, and programming provided within schools' library learning commons. Staff in the Professional Student Services Department are in the second year of implementing the Black, Indigenous, and Person of Color Mentor Group, with the goal of providing support and affirming the identity of employees within the group. Furthermore, Thames Valley District School Board's newly centralized initial assessment process has supported a more comprehensive understanding of the assets and abilities of our elementary newcomer students, thereby affirming their strengths and lived experiences. Through this process, elementary newcomer students have been provided more equitable access to system supports. Finally, in terms of goal number one, a school name review committee consisting of students, staff, and community collaborators has undertaken a comprehensive review of the names of all Thames Valley schools and school spaces named after individuals through an equity lens. The review's objective is to ensure that the names of all Thames Valley schools reflect the board's commitment to equity, diversity, and human rights, and that schools' names affirm the identity of students, staff, families, and community. Goal two. Goal two of the draft equity action plan is focused on building staff capacity to apply anti-racist and equitable practices. To support this goal, various system portfolios engaged in cross-curricular initiatives to develop a tool that would assist staff when choosing resources to use in classroom lessons through an anti-racism and equity lens. This decision-making tool for resource selection was shared with elementary and secondary staff as part of the March 4th Professional Development Day, and again on April 29th with the secondary school staff as part of their continued plan for their Professional Development Day. Goal three of the draft Equity Action Plan focuses on connectedness, building purposeful and collaborative relationships with students, staff, caregivers, and community partners that promote equity. Along with the establishment of the community and student equity and inclusion advisory committees, which were mentioned earlier in the presentation, Thames Valley has also made an investment in relationship and connectedness through a new 3-year secondary school initiatives called Relationships First. 8 secondary schools are receiving implementation support and professional development from system staff and from outside experts related to restorative practices, trauma-sensitive approaches, the essential conditions for learning, and student leadership opportunities. The main objective of this initiative is to prioritize relationships with families, students, and community partners, build understanding and respect for the identities of families, students, and community partners, and apply that understanding to all learning and interactions. Thames Valley is also focusing on supporting successful student transitions to ensure that all students and families feel welcomed and connected to their new school environment. For example, in April, a virtual kindergarten event was held where families were provided with information about the program and were able to ask questions about this new exciting journey for their young family member. In-person Welcome to Kindergarten events will be taking place over the next few weeks in all elementary schools in Thames Valley, where children will be able to visit the kindergarten classrooms and meet school teams. Another example of our focus on student transitions is the work that continues to take place over the upcoming weeks to support grade 8 students as they transition to high school. As we know, transition planning is a collaborative process involving caregivers, students, support staff, teachers, administrators, and outside organizations where applicable. As students move from grade 8 to grade 9, transition planning is student-centered and, of course, mandatory for all students on an individual education plan. The goal of all transition planning is to address barriers and ensure equitable access to programs and supports. Goal 4 of the Draft Equity Action Plan focuses on representation, cultivating a Thames Valley workforce and fostering leadership that is reflective of the diversity of students. The Human Resources team has been directly involved in supporting equity through the revision of their reference protocols by allowing for greater variation in what is considered to be a reference. The past practice of only acknowledging paid employment to serve as a reference has discouraged many newcomers from applying to positions in Thames Valley. This new approach has already resulted in a higher number of occasional teacher applications being screened and hired. Supporting diverse staff is a priority for Thames Valley. On the March 4th Professional Development Day, which was focused on anti-racism, a parallel learning session was offered for staff who identified as Black, Indigenous, a person of color, or otherwise minoritized. This first-time opportunity was offered as a response to requests from such staff to acknowledge their diversity and to allow for nuanced conversations about racism to occur with others who may share similar lived experiences. Moving forward, we are exploring the creation of a staff affinity group to extend this connection and support amongst diverse staff. We are pleased to report that next week, on May 31st, Black students from grade 8 to 12 have been invited to attend a Black Student Voice Conference. The conference will provide an opportunity for Black students to share their thoughts about equity and anti-racism, celebrate their culture, and shape initiatives moving forward for Black and all students in Thames Valley. Plans for the conference are being driven by a group of 12 Black students who represent Black student associations from Saunders, Clark Road, Beale, and Laurier Secondary Schools. Topics of discussion for the day include appropriation versus appreciation, responding to racism and microaggressions, breaking down stereotypes and misconceptions, mental health and well-being, and self-advocacy. An invitation to trustees to attend the Black Student Voice Conference has come out from the Student Planning Committee as an opportunity to invite all trustees to listen and learn from the Black students in Thames Valley. I will now turn things over to Acting Human Rights and Equity Advisor, Andrea Marlowe.
Thank you. Lastly, Goal 5 of the Draft Equity Action Plan focuses on securing accountability for change by prioritizing human rights, Indigenous rights, anti-oppression, and equity in all structures, policies, practices, and decision-making. We continue to embed human rights principles, anti-oppression strategies, and equity practices in all system and school-level planning, classroom practices, guidelines, and policies. To support this, for example, independent facility accessibility audits have been completed at all TVDSB-owned sites. The results of this audit have guided and continue to guide prioritization of accessibility-related improvements to Thames Valley facilities. The Special Education, Facility Services, and Capital Planning departments work collaboratively to determine accessibility priorities throughout the year in order to effectively allocate resources from various funding sources. Similarly, the special education portfolio continues to prioritize accountability in its planning and initiatives. Providing equitable and meaningful access to education is one of the key objectives of the Special Education Department. This work ensures, in particular, that students with individual education plans have appropriate accommodations in place. This also includes providing students who are not formally identified with an exceptionality with appropriate accommodations to ensure equitable access to the curriculum for these students without modifications. The Special Education Department has also deepened their work in providing equitable access to professional assessments, especially for those students with identities that have been historically excluded and marginalized. Lastly, working in partnership with the three children's aid societies in our area, the special education team has ensured that students in care have equitable access to Thames Valley supports and resources. Also, with respect to Goal 5, our human rights specialist and our human rights and equity advisor are working diligently to ensure that the board has a consistent, dedicated process to respond to and address complaints from students and families as well as staff regarding human rights issues. Thames Valley's Human Rights Office is providing support and guidance to the system with respect to individual human rights complaints and systemic issues, and will be working to build capacity at all levels of the organization to resolve human rights concerns in a procedurally fair and culturally safe way. Now back to you, Superintendent Skinner, for some closing remarks.
Thank you, Andrea. As a school board and as a leader when it comes to the equity work in Ontario, we are making very steady progress, and we acknowledge, however, that there is still much work to be done. We remain deeply committed to continuing to address the urgency expressed in the board motions and look forward to returning to the Board of Trustees in the new school year with another progress update. We really appreciate the opportunity to share some of the work of our teams this evening, and we would be pleased to answer any questions at this time.
Thank you, Superintendent Skinner and Acting Human Rights and Equity Advisor Marlowe, for the presentation, and again, my apologies for the interruption. Are there any questions at this time for either Superintendent Skinner or Acting Human Rights and Equity Advisor Marlowe? Yes, Trustee Roman.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. I want to take the opportunity to thank Superintendent Skinner and the equity team, Sam, Dariana, and and Andrea for being here today, but also to the rest of the team that aren't here as well, for the work that has been done on enacting the board motions, and to going above and beyond what the Board of Trustees envisioned in those motions, and taking this conversation so much further into the community. And the work you're doing is resonating. It is creating meaningful connections, and it is engaging with so many diverse community members. And it is that acknowledgement that there's work to be done, and that this is a continual process that I think meets people where they are at this time. I just wanted to comment on some of the student initiatives. There's a lot of different student initiatives taking place this time, and you highlighted the Black Students Conference coming up, which I hope to attend as well. I'm wondering if you might speak to another board motion, and that was the motion around the loss of the Afzal family, and specifically around the commemoration efforts that will be taking place. And if you might just be able to highlight in a public forum, and I know Director Fisher was on the news this morning as well doing that, just so that others have an opportunity here of the way that the family is being remembered, and the ties to the Oak Ridge community as well, and the lasting impact to the Muslim community is being identified and remembered here at Thames Valley. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Trustee Rahman, and through the chair, I'd be happy to speak to your question. The Thames Valley District School Board is working very closely with the City of London in partnering to honor the Afzal family for June the 6th, and are participating together with events leading up to that date and beyond. So if one were to go to the city website, there would be some very specific things that would be noted that are really being led by the city, but we are working alongside the city as a partner, as well as the Muslim community. In terms of the work that we are doing in Thames Valley, we are, again, as I noted in our presentation, taking lead from our Muslim partners, and as well as working alongside our mental health lead within our board, as well as within the Muslim community, to ensure that we're honoring all voices as we think about that commemoration. So on the day of June the 6th, within our school board, our flags will be lowered to half mast as we join other buildings within London and Western and other educational facilities. We are also going to have a moment of silence, and schools will decide when that fits best into their schedule for the day. Students as well have the opportunity to participate in a 15-minute walk to honor the walk that was not able to be completed by the family. The school team, the equity team, has worked alongside our Muslim community as well as the YCCR, the Youth Coalition Combating Islamophobia, to produce some teaching and learning resources, which have been shared with school staff, and we produced together lessons that address Islamophobia and at various levels, depending on the ages of the students. So these resources are available from kindergarten to grade 12. Just want to make sure I haven't forgotten anything. And again, we recognize that many families will be participating with school events as well as within the city events. So we'll support families if they choose to do that. And also, we recognize that many trustees may wish to join schools for the walk, and we welcome that, and we'd be happy to facilitate that as school superintendents. Thank you again for the question.
And if I just thank you for that, Superintendent Skinner. Just a couple of other quick things. I think we're going to have an all school signs, our London family support, and there will be a walk on Sunday, June 5th from Oak Ridge to the mosque that we certainly encourage you to join in, that we're participating in with our community partners.
Thank you, Director Fisher, and thank you, Trustee Rahman, for those comments, and thank you for the fine work. It's excellent. Thank you. And we'll move on with TVDSB School Name Review Committee report. Acting Human Rights and Equity Advisor Andrea Marlowe, thank you.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. In June 2021, the Thames Valley Board of Trustees passed a motion directing that a review be conducted of all Thames Valley schools, facilities, and learning environments named after individuals. The motion specified that the review was to ensure that the names of these Thames Valley schools, facilities, and learning environments reflect the board's policy regarding naming of schools, which states that all school names will reflect the board's commitment to promote human rights, equity, and inclusive learning environments, and honor the diversity of TVDSB schools and community. The review was also to consider the principles of decolonization, anti-racism, and anti-oppression. A committee consisting of students, staff, and community members with diverse identities, backgrounds, and experience was established to conduct the review. I'm pleased to share with you this evening for your information the committee's report, which is in your materials. Thank you for this opportunity to also provide the board with an overview of the report and propose some next steps on behalf of administration. I'll just provide, if you'd like the high-level overview, I can certainly provide that. Yeah. Okay, so this review, with the support of staff, allowed the committee to identify 67 schools and learning environments, or learning centers, and 28 learning environments at Thames Valley sites, so those are interior spaces at our schools, that are named after individuals. In its report, the committee offered general considerations about best practices for the naming and renaming of schools, facilities, and learning environments. First, the committee stated that the voices of school communities should be prioritized in reviewing school names that have local significance. Second, the committee noted the importance of school communities having access to accurate information about the individual after which their school is named. In the spirit of these considerations, the committee recommended an intentional focus on engaging the voices of specific school communities, and in some cases, the voice of the broader Thames Valley community, to review information about the individuals after which schools and learning environments are named, and consider whether the name of a school or learning environment should be changed. The committee's report stated that the Board of Trustees should consider initiating a renaming process for two Thames Valley schools, Sir John A. Macdonald Public School and F.D. Roosevelt Public School. The rationales for these recommendations are found in the committee's report. The committee also noted that Thames Valley does not have a process for naming and renaming learning environments and suggested that this be developed in alignment with the existing naming of schools policy and procedure. Further to the committee's report, administration is proposing that TVDSB administration provide an implementation plan for approval by the Board of Trustees by December 2022. Thank you for your time and attention. I'll be pleased to answer any questions.
The recommendation is that TVDSB administration provide an implementation plan for approval by the Board of Trustees by December 2022. We'll ask for a mover and a seconder for that motion. Do we have a mover?
If I may have a question first, sure. Sorry, Chair, excuse, Vice Chair Cuddy.
Excuse me. Thank you, Trustee
Roddick.
Thank you.
I just wanted to clarify because I thought it was a bit strange that we were approving a report that is going to come back to us again in December. I was under the impression that this was coming to us for information.
Thank you for that question, Trustee Reddick, and I'll do my best to answer that. And through you, Vice Chair Cuddy. So I think what we have here is a two-step process. So we have a process by which we attempted to fulfill the trustee motion to put a committee together to provide a comprehensive overview of all the existing names of schools, facilities, et cetera, and then bring that information back, which you have here tonight. And then I think the second step would be to actually take a look at those recommendations and to bring a multi-step implementation process forward to the trustees starting next December for your approval at each stage of that implementation.
Correct. So I just don't understand what we're approving tonight.
So thank you, Trustee Riddick. So what you would be approving tonight is basically a recommendation that the staff form a committee with the community, go away and develop a plan of implementation for the various components of this report, which would then be brought back to the Board of Trustees for decision and approval.
Trustee Hunt?
My question is sort of along the same lines. Do we have access to the original motion that directed this work in the first place to understand if this is a modification of the original direction? I was the mover of the motion, but I don't recall the timeline. So if staff could assist.
Yeah, I'll attempt to answer that. So you can certainly share the original motion. The original motion, it is my belief, Trustee Hunt, that asked for staff to review the names of our schools and provide recommendations for consideration for the trustees, which is contained in the report. The next step would then be to operationalize those considerations to determine what the priority would be and what the appropriate timelines would be, which would then be brought back to the trustees for approval or decision.
Okay, I'm still not sure how this conflicts because I didn't think the original motion anticipated this being a two-year process.
Respectfully, Trustee Hunt, it took a full year to rename Ryerson to Old North, and we're looking at 60, 70 different potential renaming situations.
Are there any further questions? Trustee Roman?
Thank you, and through you. And I guess I have a similar question to Trustees Ruddock and Hunt. So I see a list of recommendations by the committee within the report. So just to clarify, the motion on the floor is to take those recommendations and put together an implementation timeline around each of those recommendations. Is that okay?
Yes, thank you for that question, Trustee Rahman. That's exactly correct. So administration would be putting together an implementation plan, and it would include timelines looking at each of the specific recommendations and general considerations that have been noted in the report.
Follow-up?
Thank you, and three for follow-up. So with respect to recommendation 1 and 2 along the renaming of Sir John A. McDonald and F.D. Roosevelt Belt Public School, would both of those names be up for consideration, or would those be going back to the school community for consideration as to rename? Thank you.
I'll start to answer, Trustee Rahman, and Andrea, please fill in if I don't. So I think what we would do there is we would take a look at whether or not we would follow that same process that was followed for Ryerson to Old North for next year. We would bring that back to you for ultimately yes or no to go ahead with that. And if the answer is yes, then we would launch either 1 or 2 of the same process that we used for Ryerson. And Andrea, did I miss anything?
Yes, thank you, and through you, Chair. That's exactly right. The only other thing I would add is that we do have the fairly well-articulated process in our naming of schools policy and procedure, so that would be, if the trustees moved forward, that would be the process that we would have available to us.
Thank you. Is there anyone who has asked a question, hasn't asked a question yet, before we go to our final question from Trustee Hunt? Thank you. Seeing none. Trustee Smith, thank you.
So it has been brought to my attention on page 48 of the report, there's Lord Elgin School. So will we have the opportunity to discuss some of the findings of this committee, is that what we're saying?
Thank you for the question, Trustee Smith. I think that's what we're attempting to do here is we attempted to fulfill the spirit of the motion, which is very, very comprehensive. And then what we are asking tonight is to go back and kind of put a implementation plan in place that involves multi-steps, all of which have to be done at separate times due to staffing capacity. Each separate one would be brought back to you for decision before they were actually implemented.
Thank you.
Trustee Ruddick.
I think Director Fisher may have just answered my question. So all of these names listed, we will at a future date have the ability to the yay or nay to changing them. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, thank you for the question, Trustee Ruddick, and through the Vice Chair. That's exactly right. So there's a comprehensive overview in this report when people take the time to really dig in. But what we wanted to do is put implementation plans related to each of those recommendations and then bring them back here for your decision as a Board of Trustees about whether to proceed or not with each of the individual recommendations. And then even if we do proceed, then you just follow the process of public consultation, and that may involve the local community, the broader community, trustees, et cetera. So we don't want to rush into anything. We're not making any decisions. It's around here are all the things to consider. The committee has attempted to categorize them in terms of different areas, and then we will then bring them back in like a multi-staged way so that you guys can decide one at a time to move forward or not with the various components of the report.
Just as
a follow up, sorry, if I may comment.
Yes, please.
Along the lines of what Trustee Smith is saying, I have concerns that we are saying that Lord Elgin has limited relevance to Thames Valley today when Elgin County is named after Lord Elgin.
Thank you for that comment, Trustee Ruddick. I would just mention that in the report, many of the recommendations and considerations are really around community consultation. So the focus of the committee was to suggest that the board engage certain communities, whether it's a specific school community about a specific name or the broader Thames Valley community as a whole, around whether or not a name should be changed. So rather than taking a position, I mean, certainly there's a rationale provided for each consideration in the committee's report, but rather than taking a position, the committee is suggesting that there is some community consultation that should be engaged in, and the goal of bringing back an implementation plan would be to provide a plan around how we might approach or action that community consultation. I don't know if that helps.
Trustee Hunt.
Thank you, through your chair. I certainly appreciate the considerable amount of work and difficult discussions and consideration that's got us to this stage on the implementation of the motion. I'll note that the motion specifically, you know, directed a review where names of individuals and whatnot were out of alignment with the naming policy and the values of the board. But there seems to have been another additional category or theme that's developed, which is whether or not, even if not controversial, whether the names of individuals or in some cases individuals intertwined with geography are continue to be relevant. And that was not a part of the original direction to just to consider whether names continue to be relevant, because those are very local matters. I would like to hear through you, Chair, how that theme and that categorization or motivation became part of this review, because I think that's where, without, I don't want to mention specific schools at this stage, but this is a theme that has caused us to consider reviewing schools that seem to be outside the scope of the additional or original motion.
Trustee Hunt, this is a recommendation for an implementation plan.
Yes, but it directs us to an implementation plan that considers schools that simply might not be, with names that simply might not be relevant, and that was not part of the original.
And in that case, Trustee Hunt, you can vote against whatever you want when it comes up. I mean, Trustee.
Well, I would consider, point of order, I would consider this a modification.
Trustee Rahman and I were part of the very in-depth process with Superintendent Griffith Jones. We can tell you, because we were part of it, that it was a very, very difficult process to go through. And we Andrea Marlowe was part of this, and it was very intensive. And you can vote against it if you want when it comes up, but this is an implementation recommendation. Thank you. Any further questions? Seeing none. Trustee Rahman, thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, Trustee Moore had her hand up first. Thank you, sorry. Okay, so I just want to make sure that I don't lose focus on the specific recommendations that are included in this report and how they fit into the implementation. So specifically, I see that the committee is recommending, and I'm very grateful to the committee that was put forward in order to come back with these recommendations, because I realize how difficult these decisions are, that they've put forward the recommendation to rename Sir John A. Macdonald and F.D. Roosevelt as part of the first considerations within the implementation. What would the timeline look like for that piece? And I know that the implementation is part of this, but are we saying this is after December 2022 that we'd be looking at the possibility of any renaming? Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Rahman, for that question, and through you, Chair. I'll start by answering that, and perhaps also Superintendent Griffith Jones can comment more on the logistics and the timeline, having been through the renaming process with the former Ryerson Public School. So in bringing the implementation plan forward in December 2022, or by December 2022, we would at that point, as you've stated, be bringing forward a plan to initiate the renaming process. And that means that the existing naming of schools policy and procedure, specifically the procedure, would be activated, so to speak, and there would be specific timelines associated with the steps in that procedure. So bringing together the selection committee, there is a community consultation component as well. I don't know if Superintendent Griffith Jones would like to comment, but she certainly has a strong sense of the timelines involved in that, having been through it recently.
I'm right here. I'm right behind you. And through the chair, as you know, Trustee Cuddy and Trustee Rahman and the other trustees who are on the committee, you know the length of time it took to go through the process to come up with the new name. And then once that name was established, then becomes the challenge, the work behind the scenes, the operationalizing of the new name. So changing websites, changing letterhead, changing signs on the schools. I mean, that just doesn't happen overnight. So you have the process of changing the name itself, and then all the operationalized pieces behind that. And we've been working on that since the Old North name was approved, and we are still working on that. And we are, you know, creating a checklist, we are creating a process, and know that it takes probably a full, you know, a good 6 months to operationalize it. So you have the actual process, and then you have the behind the scenes work. And our learning from this has been that it probably takes an entire school year to actually go from beginning to end, with the idea that you would have the new name officially started the September of the next school year, and that would allow for the official ceremony to recognize the name, and there's a process behind developing a display to recognize the previous name and the new name. So it's not a quick process, and I would suggest that it probably takes a full school year to do it properly. Thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Griffith-Jones. Appreciate that. Trustee Smith.
Thank you. This is just my insecurity coming through here. I'm concerned about the Lord Elgin name because, you know, Lord Elgin is still actually very much present in Elgin County. His name is Andrew Bruce. He's the honorary colonel of our local regiment, and he travels. Well, Andrew stopped traveling here very much now. His son comes in his place because he's quite aged. And we did travel with him, the Elgin Regiment Band, back in 1992. And he prepared a concert tour of Scotland for us, including the playing at the Tattoo at the night that he was taking the salute. So I think I'd like to make sure that people know that, and I think he is still, definitely him anyway, he is still relevant as Lord Elgin to Thames Valley District School Board. Thank you.
Thank you for the question, Trustee Smith, and through you, Chair Cuddy, I'll do my best. So I think really, once people have a time to take a look at the report and read the report, what they will realize is there are some names, like Lord Elgin, where the recommendation may be to have consultation with the local community. So things are all in different categories. There is no rush to judgment. There is no, recommendation at this stage to make changes. What the recommendation tonight is to set a committee forward to try to take a look at this report in more detail, prioritize, and then come back to this Board of Trustees in December with some concrete recommendations. And as Trustee Rahman correctly pointed out, it looks like, based on the recommendations of this committee, that the first two would be to take a look at Roosevelt and McDonald for consideration about whether or not they need to be changed. And if we can, we have to determine if concurrently we could also develop a new policy and procedure around potentially renaming facilities, other things that aren't schools, because that doesn't currently exist. And so we have a lot of things that are named that may or may not be suitable. So we're a long way away from the specific things there, but this has been a really comprehensive report that has just put a lot of information out there in the public for transparency, but no decisions will be made before they come to the Board of Trustees, and really what the Board of Trustees will do is approve processes to be launched, and at the end of those processes, the Board of Trustees will then approve or not approve the recommendations of those various structures and committees.
Thank you for that assurance, and I understand. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Smith, and thank you, Director Fisher. We need to move this agenda along, so we'll bring the questions to an end, and we will ask for a mover and a seconder to this motion, for this recommendation. Trustee Gonzalez?
I'll be pleased to move this motion.
Thank you, and a seconder? Trustee Hart, thank you. We will now vote on this motion. On this recommendation, excuse me. All those in favor of this recommendation, please raise your hand. Thank you. Please lower your hands. Those opposed to this recommendation, just wait a moment, please. Those opposed, please raise your hand. The motion is carried. Thank you. Oh, student trustees, excuse me. I apologize. Do you want to vote?
We both voted in favor.
You vote in favor? Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you again. Associate Director Pratt, Superintendent Voigt, and Manager Puzanoff.
Thank you, Chair. With your indulgence, we're just shifting a few chairs and to the front row, so it'll just be 1 minute.
Why don't we take a 5 minute break?
Great.
And
thank
come
you.
Right back. So it's 9:30, so let's be back in 5 minutes, please. Thank you. Associate Director Pratt will start with the presentation before the director gets back, I guess. So.
Thank you. Thank you. All right. Thank you very much. I will turn this presentation over to Superintendent Volt.
Good evening, everyone. Administration is very pleased to be sharing with you our recommendations contained in the 2021-2022 accommodation plan. The accommodation plan and the recommendations were first shared on May 10th at the Planning and Priorities Advisory Committee meeting. The recommendations relate to the establishment of two new holding zones and a holding zone amendment in Oxford, as well as identifying schools with available space for potential facility collaboration opportunities. Our board is Southwestern Ontario's largest school board with 163 schools, close to 80,000 students, and covers the land area of more than 7,000 square kilometers. The schools, the people who work at Thames Valley, and the people we serve reside on the traditional territory of the Indigenous people, specifically the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Lenni-Lupe peoples. Our district catchment area includes the counties of Middlesex, Oxford, Elgin, as well as the cities of St. Thomas and London. And while we don't have schools within the Chippewa of the Thames First Nation, the Munsee Delaware Nation, or the United Nation of the Thames, we do have educational service agreements with these nations. I will now turn it over to Manager Puznov, who will provide a brief synopsis of the accommodation plan.
Thank you very much, Superintendent Vogt, and good evening, everyone. We'll now provide an overview of our enrollment across the district. We're projecting an average annual elementary enrollment increase of 0.7% through 2026-2027, with facility utilization across the elementary panel set to exceed 100% district-wide by the 2023-2024 school year. Secondary enrollment is projected to increase more rapidly at 1.7% per year to the 2026-2027 school year, given the large elementary cohorts progressing through. Utilization in the secondary panel is projected to surpass 100% by the 2026-2027 school year. Imbalances between enrollment and available pupil places have been an issue, and this is projected to continue, making the work required through attendance area review processes that much more critical. On the whole, enrollment across the elementary panel in Elgin, as well as St. Thomas, is projected to increase in the short term. Growth is expected to be more significant in the secondary panel, particularly in St. Thomas. A significant amount of land has also been designated for residential development in Northwest St. Thomas. That area has not been factored into these enrollment projections at this time, as planning applications have not yet been filed. We're continuing to monitor that particular matter with our colleagues over at the city's planning department, and we do project that enrollment in this part of the city will continue increasing once construction activity begins. Enrollment across the elementary panel in Middlesex County is projected to continue growing as well, largely driven by residential development activity throughout its many settlement areas. The secondary panel in Middlesex is also projected to continue growing, with enrollment at Medway High School growing due to the grade cohorts moving through the elementary panel, both in London and Middlesex. Strathroy District Collegiate Institute and Glencoe District High School are also projected to grow. The elementary panel in Oxford County is projected to experience steady growth as well over the next 5 years, with much of that growth occurring as a result of development activity in Woodstock, Ingersoll, Tillsonburg, as well as northern parts of the county. The secondary panel is also projected to grow, with Woodstock Collegiate Institute, College Ave Secondary School, Huron Park Secondary School, and Ingersoll District Collegiate Institute all projected to experience growing enrollment. And finally, elementary enrollment in London is projected to continue increasing over the next 5 years. This is largely being driven by new residential development activity in the suburbs, as well as infill redevelopment in various built-up areas of the city. The enrollment increase in the secondary panel is projected to be more significant, and this again can be attributed to the large elementary cohorts progressing through. I'll now turn the presentation back over to Superintendent Vogt to review the recommendations that form this part of this year's accommodation plan update.
As part of our accommodation plan update, we are proposing the creation of two new holding zones, as well as undertaking a holding zone amendment. The first new holding zone proposed is for the site of the redevelopment of the Ingersoll Golf Club. This project is situated within the attendance area of Harrisfield Public School, which is over capacity and limited in the number of portables that can be housed on the site. Lori Hawking Public School is the only school in town with available pupil space and the site area to accommodate students from this proposed subdivision. Administration has been in discussion with both county staff and the developer regarding this development, and a school block is planned to be incorporated into the design in order to provide permanent accommodation to students through a new school when one is approved by the Ministry of Education. There is significant residential construction activity occurring in Woodstock, with a considerable development development proposal recently submitted in the city's southwest for land that was annexed into the corporate boundary. The proposal is located within the attendance area of Central Public School, which is currently full due to providing interim accommodation for three holding zones in the city's north end. It is proposed that Eastdale Public School provide temporary accommodation to students in Southwest Woodstock until the new North Woodstock Elementary School opens, at which time students in the North Woodstock holding zone would be accommodated at the new school and space becomes available at Central. In addition to the establishment of the new Southwest Woodstock holding zone, a holding zone amendment is proposed in the city's north. As mentioned, the three holding zones at the north end of the city are currently being accommodated at Central Public School. With the growth occurring in this area, enrollment at the holding school is projected to continue increasing, and there is limited space for portables on the site. As a result, a holding zone amendment for the area is recommended in order to manage enrollment until the new North Woodstock Elementary School opens. Given its location and available space, Zorro Highland Park Public School is recommended as the holding school for all new families moving into three existing holding zones. Siblings of existing holding students at Central Public School would continue to have the option to attend that school. Through the annual planning exercises, school boards are required to identify schools that may be suitable for facility collaboration. At a minimum, schools with utilization rates of less than or equal to 60% for two consecutive years, or schools that have 200 or more available pupil spaces, are considered for such opportunities. It is recommended that the schools on this slide be approved for potential facility collaborations. I'd like to take a few minutes to review the recommendations with you. That a new holding zone, Ingersoll Greens Holding, be established within the attendance area of Harrisfield Public School for the redevelopment of the Ingersoll Golf Club, and that all K-8 students from the holding zone attend Lori Hawkins Public School until permanent accommodations are available. That a new holding zone, Southwest Woodstock Holding, be established within the attendance area of Central Public School, and that all K-8 students from the holding zone attend Eastdale Public School until permanent accommodations are available. That three North Woodstock holding zones currently being accommodated at Central Public School be amended, and that new K-8 families within these holding zones be accommodated at Zorro Highland Park Public School until permanent accommodations are available. And that the following schools listed below be approved for potential facility collaborations: Ealing Public School, B. Davidson Secondary School, Montcalm Secondary School, Clark Road Secondary School, Westminster Secondary School, North Middlesex District High School, Glencoe District High School, Ingersoll District Collegiate Institute, Port Burwell's Public School, Springfield Public School, Arthur Bowden Secondary School, and West Elgin Secondary School. Thank you again for your attention on this matter, and we'd be pleased to take any questions you have.
Thank you, Superintendent Vogt. Do we have any questions at this time for the presenters? Okay, seeing none. Does anyone need me to reread the motion, or are we prepared to move forward and with a vote? We'll need a mover and a seconder. Trustee Yeoman? Thank you. And a seconder? Trustee Hart, thank you. This now enters into debate. Thank you. Trustee Hart.
Just a comment. Trustee Yeoman and I did spend time with the planning team answering questions and having a discussion, and so very supportive of it. I think it's a move in the right direction. So I think we can move through this quite quickly. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Hart. Okay, we'll move on with the vote. All those in favor of the we're going to roll all three into one. All those in favor of the recommendation, please raise your hand and keep them raised. Everyone lower your hand, please. Those opposed to the motion, please raise your hand. The motion is carried. Thank you. Motion two, I will turn over to Trustee Yeoman.
Thank you very much. In Chair Pizzolatto's absence, I would like to bring forward a motion on her behalf for the consideration of the board. It is on the screen there, as we see, that the chair write a letter to the new Minister of Education when appointed to consider increasing capital benchmark funding for building of new schools, additions, and other repairs, increase funding to the school condition improvement plan and school renewal allocation grants to reduce Thames Valley's capital backlog, which presently is at $694,156,214 and is forecasted to increase to $912,786,155 within the next 5 years. Decreasing approval timelines through land acquisitions and constructions of the new school. I ask for your consideration of this motion.
Thank you, Trustee Yeoman. Could we ask for a seconder for the motion? Trustee Gonzalez. We'll now go to debate. Trustee Yeoman.
Well, thank you. My understanding of this after speaking with Lorianne this afternoon, I was quite interested to hear this motion and the thoughts behind it. And I do feel that it is a fair motion to put forward to support our administration effort, because I do believe they're doing an excellent job. I'm sure that Trustee Pizzolatto would take any questions that anyone had, though, to flesh out her thinking as well.
Thank you, Trustee Yeoman. And Trustee Gonzalez, would you like to speak to the motion?
No, I agree with Trustee Yeoman, and I think it is important that we establish that relationship and priorities with the incoming Minister of Education.
Thank you. Trustee Pizzolatto, would you like to make any comments?
Sure. Thank you, and through the chair. I think we've been all advocating for this throughout our term, that we've realized, you know, with the pandemic and the increased cost of constructions, that the benchmark needs to be increased for building of new schools. Our backlog is huge, and I think it needs to be reduced. So increasing those two grants would help us reduce our backlog for fixing schools. And one of the items that we have been advocating for since the beginning is decreasing in the timelines from approval of land to the construction, so that we can get seats in the school quicker, so that when we open schools, they don't open over capacity. So that would help that situation. So I hope that helps.
Thank you, Trustee Pizzolatto. Is there any further debate on this motion? Seeing none, we will move to a vote. All those in favor of this motion, please raise your hand and keep them raised. Thank you. Please lower your hand. All those opposed to this motion, please raise your hand and keep it raised. That motion is carried. Thank you. Report from board committees. Thames Valley Parent Involvement Committee, March 10th, 2022. Trustee Polhill.
Yes, thank you. This meeting was held prior to the March break, and some of the, obviously the minutes aren't closed, but some of the points to note are just that the subcommittee was formed for financials and planning, and that we, this was the meeting upon which we elected the chair of the committee, which has already come to the board and passed. And other than that, basically this was just talking about the previous mask mandates, et cetera. So a lot of the business of this meeting has now come to pass. If there's any questions, I can take those, or they can be answered by Superintendent Builder.
Thank you, Trustee Polhill. Are there any questions for Trustee Polhill or Superintendent Builder? Seeing none, thank you very much, Trustee Polhill. Yes. Thames Valley Parent Involvement Committee, April 21st, 2022, Trustee Polhill.
Sorry, this is the one of April 21st, yes?
Yes, please. Thank you.
So the committee met. The meeting minutes are enclosed. We did receive a guest. Superintendent Moynihan presented the EQAO in Thames Valley and gave the opportunity to our members to ask questions. That was received very well. Special Education Department, Special Education Advisory Committee was presented by Superintendent Canaham, and that also was received very well. A lot of questions in regards to the pandemic and supports, etc. All of the questions and answers are in the minutes of the meeting. This was the first meeting of our new chair. And it went very well. There were some questions in regarding masking, et cetera. And throughout this meeting there, I presented that we were looking for budget input. The financial committee provided an update, and nothing else to note, but if there are any questions, I can take them as well as Superintendent Builder.
Thank you, Trustee Polhill. Are there any questions at this time for Trustee Polhill or Superintendent Builder? Seeing none, but I'd like to go back to Trustee Moore. You may have had a comment to make earlier. Did you have anything to say about the SEAC presentation today that you wanted to say?
So I was going to report on 14B there.
Okay, yeah, good.
But
all right.
Just figured you'd catch me again because there are a bunch of SEAC reports tonight, so I knew that we were going to get there.
Okay.
Okay. So the committee met on April 11th, 2022, and in that one we did discuss the equity presentation that we received the previous month, and there is further dialogue pending about that. The SEAC Giftedness Program Review Subcommittee also updated that the work was completed on the scope document. So that was officially disbanded, and a working group it's moving into a working group model. So the report is in the package, and minutes will be posted on the website when they are ready. Recommendations coming out of that meeting, we already heard from Christine's terrific presentation. Thank you. Happy to take questions, obviously. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Trustee Moore. Any questions for Trustee Moore at this time? Seeing none, we will move on. Thank you, Trustee Moore. Policy Working Committee. I'm sorry, Trustee Moore. My apologies. You have another word from May 3rd.
I do. Item 14D. The CIAC committee met on Tuesday, May 3rd, 2022. Again, the report is in the package and the minutes will be posted, but some items of interest. We did discussed the draft letter to the ministry, which has since been sent regarding PPM 81. And we discussed some of the standards that we continue to work on, and more discussion about the individual education plan audit. Which is now completed for this year. And again, happy to take questions.
Thank you, Trustee Moore. Any questions at this time? Seeing no questions, thank you, Trustee Moore.
There's one more.
Oh, one more presentation, please. Thank you. Yes, please. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry. Thank you. Yes.
So the committee also met on May 16th, 2022. We discussed the preliminary special education budget. We also had a presentation on the Rural Education Task Force report, and discussed more standards of the special education plan. There's an annual review going on in collaboration with staff. And there will be recommendations coming from our June meeting. And again, happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much. Any questions at this time for Trustee Moore? Seeing none, thank you very much. Program and School Services Advisory Committee, May 3rd, 2022. Trustee Polhill.
Through you, Chair, I think this is me.
I'm sorry, it is.
Not a problem. It's actually you, and I'm filling
in. It's acting Vice Chair. Raman, thank you very much.
Thank you. So the content of the meeting that took place on May 3rd is in front of you in the report. We talked about the re-engagement strategy update, graduation rate update, summer learning, and then we discussed Superintendent Moynihan's retirement. So thank you for that, and that is it for the report. Thank you.
Thank you, Acting Vice Chair Raman. Are any questions at this time? Seeing none, we will move on to Policy Working Committee, May 10th, 2022. Vice Chair Raman, thank you.
Thank you, and through you. So the committee met on May 10th at 3 o'clock. The discussion was around the disconnection from work procedure, the assessment, evaluation, and reporting on student achievement policy and procedure was the bulk of the conversation. There's a motion that's included here as well. I'll put that motion on the floor right now, Chair, if you're okay with it.
Please.
Thank you. The committee is bringing the following recommendation forward: that assessment, evaluation, and reporting student achievement policy as amended be approved. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we need it? We need a seconder for this, please, Trustee Moore. Thank you. Do we have debate? Debate on this? Trustee Robin, would you like to speak to your motion?
Thank you. I will speak to the motion. The committee had extensive consultation on the policy and the procedure here included in. 146 individuals responded to the public input.
so quite extensive, and significant discussion was had in committee around the policy and the changes that we could make within the policy. Thank you.
Thank you. And Trustee Moore, would you like to speak to your second of the motion?
I would not. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion or debate? We will now vote on this motion. All those in favor, please raise your hand and keep it up. We get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Thank you. Please lower your hands. All those opposed to the motion, please raise your hand. Oh, sorry. Sorry. Take a moment and take your hands down. All those in favor. Oh, sorry. All those opposed, please raise your hand. That motion is carried. Thank you. Planning and Priorities Advisory Committee of May 10th, 2022. Acting Vice Chair Rahman.
Thank you, and through you. The committee met on May 10th, starting at 6 p.m. The preliminary budget GSN was discussed at length, as well as the restricted grants and priorities and partnership funding. The online budget consultation survey results were provided. From there, some questions were asked, and more significant or more input was requested based on what was provided. The accommodation plan, which was presented this evening, was provided, and questions were asked by trustees, and the capital priorities update was also provided. The recommendation was to move that report to this board meeting, and that was done this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions at this time? Seeing none, thank you. Move on with Special Education Advisory Committee, May 16th, 2022. Trustee Moore. Oh, we did that one. Pardon me. Did we do that one? Yes, thank you. I thought so. Chair's Committee, May 17th, 2022. Acting Chair Rahman, thank you.
Thank you, and through you. The committee met on May 17th at 1 p.m. There was discussion at the committee level around the equity learning opportunities overview. So looking at learning opportunities for trustees around equity. The motion passed at committee that the training be deferred until 2023 for the new term of trustees. There was an electronic vote that was reported in on some funding for student trustees to attend upcoming conferences. There was approval of the board advisory schedule. Instead of reviewing it at this meeting, we are going to approve and have it at the next chair's committee meeting. We discussed public input that was provided this evening in terms of just scheduling that. And we also discussed what to do about the filling the PASA chair within the time period that we have left in advance of the next meeting, and you'll see that discussion there. Happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions at this time? Seeing none, thank you very much. First Nations Advisory Committee. Trustee Antone had to leave, and I believe that Acting Vice Chair Rahman will take this one.
Thank you, and through you. Unfortunately, the committee did not have quorum at May 17th meeting, and they have now scheduled a meeting for June 22nd.
Thank you. Board Governance and Bylaw Review Committee, Trustee Polhill.
Yes, you have the minutes in front of you, but the points to be taken is that the committee discussed the next steps, which included trustee involvement and providing input into our parliamentarian in order to have our bylaws reviewed. expectations of the first session were discussed. We also discussed the review of the Education Act relevant to the Code of Conduct. Following this discussion, basically what we did was we discussed how other boards were looking at the Code of Conduct and decided whether it was within the mandate of the committee. And it was determined that a working group would be formed in order to make sure that our board bylaws were aligned. We also discussed the work of the committee in regards to trustee orientation, trustee handbook, updating, approving the Code of Conduct, and reviewing the trustee honorarium. The next meeting is scheduled for September 19th at 5 p.m., but we are having informal sessions to be held with the parliamentarian to complete, because the parliamentarian will be completing the full bylaw review. And we have a tentative date set for May 30th, as well as June 27th, September 6th, and September 21st. So those should be going out into your calendars. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to take them at this time.
Thank you. Any questions for Trustee Polhill at this time? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to trustee updates from external committees. I'm terribly sorry, Acting Vice Chair Rahman. I missed the last one, Committee of the Whole in camera, May 24th, 2022.
Thank you, and through you. The committee met in camera this evening, May 24th, from 5 p.m. to 5:30 to discuss personal matters. No conflicts of interest were declared. The recommendation I'm putting forward that the motion approved at the in-camera session of May 24th related to personnel be approved. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions at this time? Oh, we have to approve this one. Thank you. All in favor of the motion, please raise your hand and keep them raised. Okay. All right, please lower your hand. Those opposed? That motion is carried. Thank you. Moving on to updates from external committees, the Ontario Public School Boards Association, Trustee Ruddick.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. Not much of an update. We look forward to the AGM starting June the 9th. Please check your email as we have received lots of correspondence from OPSPA. And if you need any emails forwarded, I would be happy to do so.
Sorry, could you read the date of that meeting, please, Trustee Ruddick?
The AGM starts on June the 9th.
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions for Trustee Ruddick at this time? Yes, Trustee Gonzalez.
Just one question to confirm that Trustee Ruddick and or Trustee Hunt will be in fact attending in person as the voting delegates for TVDSB at OPSPA's AGM, if they can confirm that.
We're still in conversations with OPSPA as to how the format of the meeting is going to be run. So when we know, if we have any changes, we will let our alternates know as soon as we know.
Follow up, Trustee Gonzalez?
Yes, follow up. I would appreciate that very much. As the alternate for OPSPA, I do plan to attend in person, and it is my understanding that that is the expectation from OPSPA. Furthermore, and if I can just make a comment, following Trustee Ruddick's suggestion that everybody checks their email regardless of who the voting delegate is. There are several policy resolutions for the 2022 OPSPA Annual General Meeting, and would appreciate any feedback from any trustees for direction on that.
Thank you, Trustee Gonzalez. The Thames Valley Education Foundation, Trustee Hart.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. I just want to highlight from the Foundation's point of view the Caring Fund. In June the 13th to the 17th, we'll be launching the 5 days you want. And just to say a little bit about the Caring Fund, requests have increased about 60% over the last year. And so now we're supporting about 600 families with $212,000. And in the last couple of weeks, we've been averaging 5 requests per day. We really need more help to make sure we can continue supporting families in need. So we just want to highlight this in June and hope that all trustees will get involved. So the question is, how can you help? One of the ways is to share posts and engage your followers on social media. This is a good news story, I think, and as trustees, it's the kind of outreach to the community we should be making at this time, particularly with regard to the Caring Fund. Secondly, sign up for the event and fundraise for the Caring Fund. Again, it's June 13th to the 17th, so keep those dates in mind. And you can even put a team of your family and friends together too for as part of this fundraising. So you'll receive, as trustees, an email and a toolkit later in the week with some more details about this. And as always, thank you for your support. The Caring Fund has been used more than ever before this year, and we want to make sure that we continue to support our students. So in the past, as a trustee, I've been involved with scholarships and bursaries, and that was the unique thing that we tried to raise in the community. But I think this is our future in terms of a Caring Fund, and this is the kind of thing as trustees we need to focus on as a need for our students. I'd be glad to answer any questions with regard to the Caring Fund.
Thank you, Trustee Hart. Are there any questions at this time? Seeing none, thank you again, Trustee Hart. The Special Education Advisory Committee membership. We have an appointment letter from Autism Ontario. Trustee Moore, would you like to move the following motion?
I would like to move that we accept the member as present, that Chris McGowan be appointed to the Special Education Advisory Committee, SEAC, as the representative for Autism Ontario for the remainder of the 2018 to 2022 term. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Moore. Do we need a second for that? Well, why don't we'll take a second for it. Trustee Yeoman, thank you. Debate, and Trustee Moore, would you like to comment on that?
Not much to speak to other than the hole in their membership was created when I stepped down off the committee as the representative for Autism Ontario on SEAC. So I know they've had some challenges in trying to get a representative on the committee, so I'm very pleased that they have sorted that out, and I hope that we can vote to accept.
Thank you. Trustee Yeoman?
Sure. I'd just like to thank Trustee Moore for all the work that she has done on SEAC over the years, and we'll look forward to working with Chris in this capacity.
Thank you, Trustee Yeoman. Further debate? Seeing no further debate, we will have a vote on this motion. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Keep it raised. Please lower your hands. Those opposed to this motion, wait. All those opposed to the motion, please raise your hand. Seeing none, thank you. The motion is approved. Notice of motion. The notice of motion was presented to the agenda package and will be addressed at the June 28th, 2022 board meeting. Notice of which is motion has been given. Trustee Hart, do you want to take this?
Thank you. I'm bringing this motion forward because I think we need to focus on the classroom, and I think coming back to the Board of Trustees for the last several months, I think there's a lot of discussion about other issues, and I think a couple of months ago we dealt with the issue of the distribution of trustees. And I'm one of the few people in the room likely that was here in 1998 when we had this discussion, and it was really a pre-NUP kind of when all of the four boards joined together. The expectation was that we would recognize each other and move forward, and it became disruptive having before each election to vote again on what the distribution would be. And I think this would be one way to kind of set that kind of discussion aside and focus a little bit more on the classroom. And I say that having visited a few schools and talked to teachers recently, I think we really need to focus on what's going on in the classroom. And one of the ways is to limit the amount of discussion we're having about how the trustees are elected. Because once trustees are chosen, we really, all 12 and plus the Indigenous trustee, the 13 of us, need to realize that we're here to represent all of the students. And our focus is the preparation of students for their next event in life, I guess I would call it, whether they're going directly into the workplace or whether they're going to college or university. That really has to be our focus. So my purpose in bringing this motion forward is that we would set aside those kinds of political discussions and have a little bit more focus on what's going on in the classroom. And I am quite concerned that in not just this year, but in coming years, that really has to be much more of the Board of Trustees' focus. So that's why I'm bringing this motion forward. It's up there on the screen. I won't take time to read it. The reason for the wording the way it is that the regulation has to be changed by the Ministry of Education. And that's the purpose of just writing a letter. And then again, it's up to the Ministry of Education as to whether or not they will change this. This isn't something we can direct ourselves. So that's the purpose in writing it this way. So the chair would write a letter and ask the Ministry of Education to make these changes. I'd be glad to answer any questions if anybody needs clarification.
Thank you. Any questions for Trustee Hart on the motion? Trustee Smith.
I just wondered if we needed a seconder.
I'm sorry. Yes, we do need a seconder. Thank you.
I'll be glad to second this motion.
Thank you, Trustee Smith. Thank you. Any questions for Trustee Hart at this time? And does anyone require us to read it? I don't see that anyone has a requirement that it be read aloud, so we will move on to debate. And Trustee Hart, would you like to make any further comments?
No, I think I've said enough already.
Thank you. And as the seconder, Trustee Smith, would you like to make any comments?
Really not a whole bunch, just that I think Trustee Hart has a great idea here and a good reason for it. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Smith. Trustee Gonzalez?
Are we in the part of debate?
Yes, still debate.
Thank you. I appreciate the intention of focusing on student achievement, as that is our main role. However, the world is not static. Society keeps moving and changing. And I think we have seen, even from the enrollment projections, that we don't know what will happen in a year or two, let alone 4 or 8. On the other hand, it's not the same world as it was in 1998. And I do think that there needs to be room for regular reassessment and consideration and room to be creative in some solutions that may not exist right now, that there could be a different distribution that we have yet to imagine. So for those reasons, I would not support this motion. The other factor is that as people move across the province or across a region, we don't know that even the allocation from the for our trustees for this area will remain at 12. We don't even know that at this time. So I do think that if we talk about students, student achievement, they're also be coming into the workforce in jobs that do not exist yet, as many of us have even taken jobs that did not exist when we were students. So for those reasons, and I do think that the world is changing and it's not going to stop changing, it's not in the best interest of Thames Valley to try to maintain a static position on this matter, and there is room to be creative and reassess regularly. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Gonzalez. Trustee Rahman.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. I understand the intent of the motion, and while I see the value, absolutely, I think that, you know, this term we've had a lot more discussion around distribution, but also the balance of the board. But I do agree with my trustee colleague, Trustee Gonzalez, that locking in our number at 12 through board motion seems, in my opinion, to not flow with the what is outlined in the ministry directive anyways, which says that this number needs to fluctuate based on population, and it needs to grow if the population grows. So I think from the perspective of, although it's great that that conversation took place in the past around what the arrangement should be. The regulation sets out that this needs to be reviewed by each Board of Trustees before an election for a reason, and I won't be supporting that motion for this reason. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Rahman. Any further discussion? Any other comments? Seeing none, we will bring this debate to an end and we will go to a vote. Again, does anyone need the motion to be read aloud? Everyone satisfied? All right, all those in favor of this motion, please raise their hand. Thank you. Please lower them. All those opposed to this motion, please raise their hand. That motion is carried. Thank you. Questions and comments by members? Any trustees have any comments at this time? Any questions? Yes, Trustee Polhill.
Yes, I'm wondering if we can get an update on where we're at with the Belmont development, if there's any movement.
Associate Director Pratt.
I'll take that one. Okay, thank you for the question through the chair. All of our paperwork is submitted to the Ministry of Education. We are still awaiting further feedback or word from them at this point.
A follow-up?
Thank you.
Follow-up, Trustee Paul?
Nope, just asking in regards to a constituent.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Superintendent Vogt. Trustee Ruddock.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. Thank you to Trustee Polhill. That was also my question. Second question, just wondering if we can get an update as to security at the board office. during board meetings. What is, like, we didn't in the past always have security. I'm just wondering, why, I guess.
Thank you, Trustee Ruddick. I'll ask Superintendent Nichols to take this question.
Thank you, and through you, Chair. As you were aware, at our October board meeting, we had a serious violent protest outside of our One World Education Center, wherein our director received direct threats to himself and to his family members and had his personal vehicle damaged. Other staff and board members who are here tonight also experienced this traumatic event. Police were present, and they were unable to disperse the crowd. In a subsequent debrief with them, with our health and safety supervisor, they recommended that security be in place for any public meeting that was anticipated to be contentious. As aligned with most public health, most public leaders in our area, a safety plan was also recommended, and that was developed for our director since that time. The director has continued to receive multiple continued hostile and threatening emails. We've had protesters coming here to attempt to meet with him during business hours, follow him leaving the parking lot, circle his car, and even as of last month, attempt to sneak through the loading dock to serve him with papers. Our communication department also continues to receive very negative and threatening emails. As such, our health and safety department has recommended that security be in place for the remainder of the school year for any public meetings, and we will reassess that need over the summer. And I need to note, this is not dissimilar to the plans we put in place for our schools, albeit our schools are not public buildings and that they're not open to the public and we keep them closed to the public during the day, we do hire security or have safety specialists on site when we receive concerns as to external violence. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Nichols. Any further questions at this time? Seeing none, we will ask for a adjournment. Can I have someone to make a motion to adjourn?
Thank you, Trustee Owen. We combined it at the front part of the meeting. We did news from the system, and so we could highlight it when people are still fresh. We're 4 hours in.
Yes, but now that you have your hand up, Trustee Yeoman, I'll ask you to make the motion that we adjourn.
Sorry, through you. Oh, there was a hand up. Never mind.
There's a hand up. Okay, and seconder, Trustee Moore, thank you very much. We are adjourned. All in favor? Yes, thank you. Thank you.